Friday. It's April 19th, 2019 from the Troy Lee Design Saloon in Corona, California. It is the Whiskey Throttle Show. Thanks for tuning in. We're back after a little break. Took some time to kind of reassess where we were at here with the show. We're working on some renovation on the set, so if this looks a little different, it's in progress here. We'll get there in the next show or two and have it dialed in. And our producer, DJ Donnie, took himself a nice little vacation. Speaking of my team here, let me introduce you to GL, Grant Langston, the co-host of this mess, and DJ Donnie over there on the big computer. Welcome, boys.
Thanks.
Today, we have 11-time Baja 1000 winner and off-road legend Johnny Campbell here with Johnny Campbell Racing. This guy has done it all in the off-road world, and I'm stoked to hear his story and just get to know him a little bit better. So excited for him to be on.
Yeah, it's nice. I mean, we've, we always try to focus predominantly on motocross, but off-roading in this part of the world has a huge following. It's something I learned a lot about when I moved to the States, is like basically, as we call it, desert racing. It's massive. So there's a lot of crossover, and I think it's cool. You know, we had Twitch, you know, freestyle. Got Johnny from the off-road side.
Yeah.
A little mix-up.
Now we're going to do some more of that. You know, we got some road race guys we want to bring in, some even people from outside of the motorcycle.
People with
world,
interesting stories.
That's it.
That's what we go for.
Yeah, and he's brought to you today by PowerDot. That's our title sponsor, and we just couldn't do this without those guys. We really appreciate their help. If you're looking at one of these units, and they're growing in popularity because they work, go to PowerDot.com, check them out. 20% off if you type in Whiskey Throttle at checkout. A lot of people have taken advantage of that, and we really appreciate it. Method Race Wheels, also a big supporter of the show. Decal Works, they're the ones actually building the graphics for our set behind us, so I'm excited to see what those come in looking like. Four Wheel Parts, Troy Lee Designs, Adidas, Pro Circuit, Dunlop Tires, and Nihilo Concepts. Some great people behind us, and also want to thank RacerX. If you're not already a subscriber, get over to RacerX online, subscribe. You're going to get content you can't get anywhere else. You know, I have people say to me, oh, I don't need to subscribe. I just read the website. It's totally different things. The website is geared towards results, things that are happening right now, kind of current event stuff. The stuff we do in the book, there's historical pieces, there's in-depth pieces on different riders, there's all kinds of stuff you're not going to get on the web. So go to RacerX online, check them out. Also, if you go to RacerXbrand.com, you get 20% off typing in whiskey at checkout. So if you're looking for some kind of new summer swag or whatever, check them out. Let's get right into the Method Race Wheels front end chatter. These guys bringing you the fastest, lightest off-road truck wheels for your Sprinter, your SUV, UTV, whatever you got. Check them out. And we're all set. We're going to the Dirtfish Rally Driving School here next end of the month.
Pumped. So pumped.
Oh, it's coming up. A couple weeks away. We picked a winner. He's from somewhere, I want to say, gosh, where was he from? Oregon, maybe? Nah, he was going to drive up. He was close enough he could drive to the thing.
Well,
so anyway.
That worked out well.
Stoked to get up there and do that. We'll share some video clips and photos and stuff of that once we're done. That's going to be a lot of fun. And we're going to do that again in the fall. So don't feel like you've completely missed your chance. But check out methodracewheels.com. So a couple things we want to talk about. First of all, after this weekend, it seems like Eli Tomac has finally sorted out his settings. You know, when we spoke to him here on the show early in the season, he said, I'm just looking for that little sweet spot where I'm comfortable all the time. You know, he's like, at that point, he was like, I'm getting close. But I think it took them some time. There was a lot of drama over the crew chief over there at Cowie, whether or not he was not letting him go the direction he wanted to go. Coincidentally, he does not work there any longer. And it seems like Eli's kind of found that sweet spot now where he's happy. I mean, he looks comfortable. He was so aggressive there in the opening laps of Denver. I thought, oh, man, he's going to throw it away. He's trying too hard. And he pulled it.
Well, my only thought, though, is, was it Denver home crowd? You heard the crowd going nuts. Was it just another weekend where Eli was on it? And then are we going to see maybe not the same Eli show up to the next round in New Jersey? I don't know, because at times he's a mystery. He can be literally the fastest guy in the world on any given day. And then other days you look and you're going, something's missing. And like you said, with the whole Kawasaki, it was weird in the sense, you know, that there was a lot of tension and issues going on, but everyone seemed pretty hush about it. So I feel like I don't know the exact details of what was happening there. But like you said, there's some people have gone, some people have come. There's been some shakeup. It looks like it's going in the right direction. But once again, Eli might be the guy that wins the most races.
Yeah.
And not the title.
Hey, on a side
note. And I think that's where it's got to be frustrating for him by now.
On a side note, you've never seen Eli so talkative and forthcoming as you have this year.
Yeah.
He's like been super honest in the press conferences, super happy. You see when he's happy, you see when he's not, and I've never seen him talk so much.
Yeah, that's good. And the thing that really throws me off is it's not like he's always struggles when it's hard slick, or he always struggles when rut. It's like
it's a mixed bag.
It's just a mixed bag.
Yeah, it's just what weekend is this? Oh no, it's not one for me.
Yeah, and I honestly think it's just a comfort thing for him. I don't think that there's he's struggling mentally to get back into it. I just think he hasn't found a setting where he's just comfortable all the time, and that could just be him on that day or whatever. Mm-hmm. But when you know how it is, when you find a setting you're comfortable with, it's just like you and that bike are one, and it's everything's easy. And I'm curious to see if he's got that setting now. He's already kind of admitted this title's gone. He just doesn't want to be struggling coming into next year. And
for sure not.
Unfortunately, they had to start over with a new bike because I think he already had a comfortable setting on the 18.
I wonder if someone's calling Kawi Japan going, no changes for 2020, no changes, keep it the same.
Don't change a thing.
We're on a good path here.
Grips and graphics.
Yes, change the color of the graphics and a seat cover.
Yeah, so we'll see what happens. I'm stoked for Eli. It seems like that was a really cool win for him there in Denver at his hometown.
Yeah.
The other thing I want to mention, man, late season injuries, brutal. Mm-hmm. Dean Wilson, sounds like his isn't as bad, but banged up his shoulder, bruised kidney, it sounds like. He's going to take a few weeks off and be back. But, boy, he didn't need that. He was putting together such a great season, trying to land himself a ride for next year, and that's not how you want to end it.
With Dino, he's one of those guys, like, because he's such a nice guy and everyone likes him, and this seems to happen all too often, it sucks. When you see him go down, you almost want to say, anyone but Dino, like, come on. And it's a tough sport. You look, both the 250 and the 450 class, I was watching it the other night. I'm like, these guys are just, like, finely tuned race machines nowadays. Like, you go look at old footage. We were here, there. We looked like we were Whiskey Throttle. Everyone now is so perfect, so precise, that if you're off just a little bit, you could be outside the top 10. So for factory guys, this becomes like an ego thing as well. It's embarrassing if you're a top guy and you're outside the top 10. So everyone, I feel like almost like the noose has been tightening a little bit. Everyone's pushing. And with the speed and everything, mistakes are happening.
Well, and Dean has been at the front more this year than you've seen like ever.
It's been his best year
ever. He's doing fantastic.
Yeah. He's been riding really well. And every time you get injured, it's two steps back. And then you got to try and play catch up for another few months. But I personally think that maybe something needs to change in Supercross. Because if you look at the trends, I think you're going to see more and more injuries. And they can try and tow down the track. But when the bikes are going that fast.
But see, I think that's where they get it wrong. We say, let's make the track safer
and
easier.
Yeah, but then they're flying.
And then they're going too fast.
Yeah.
And then when you do go down, it's higher speed and the injuries are more. I say go back to the 90s, early 2000s, where stuff was tight and steep and technical.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was peakier and it would be a little poppier, but you're going slow.
But most of the guys, if something went wrong, they could jump off and walk away.
Yeah.
Now when guys are going down, it's like a bad car crash, you know?
Yeah.
Anyway, I just worry about the safety of the riders for sure. And I think that conversation needs to happen where people, maybe some intelligent people can get together and sit down and put their egos aside and go, hey, how can we do this?
That'll never happen.
That's right. Yep.
When you said intelligent people.
Hold on. Let's just throw that out of the window.
Well, like they're basically riding on a razor's edge,
intelligent people, bring in some riders, bring in some mechanics, bring in some engineers, bring in some promoters, bring people that know what they're talking about and say, all right, they've got an agenda. You know, if you felt, I don't know, if not having riders getting injured is a good thing for them. You know, crashing is part of the show. I mean, so there's that fine line where people want to see some carnage, but they don't want to see people get hurt.
They're always going to crash, though. And this is the thing that I, like the example I use is make whoops right out of a turn and make them big and make them long.
Yep.
Right? It's technical. It's tough. People will crash, but they're not going to be going a million miles
an
hour.
They're going slow.
Instead, they land off a triple, make them grab fourth or fifth and go into a set of whoops.
So if something goes wrong,
they're done.
It's going to go really wrong.
You know, they need to do... My recommendation, this one may never happen, but do a rider's summit, like a meeting or an industry summit at the end of every season and say, okay, hey, here was the year. Riders, team managers, mechanics, anybody, give us some feedback. What did you like? What did you not like?
Well, no one follows stats like how many riders were injured and how many times and what that compares to 2017, 2016. But It does seem like.
Well, I think the Alpine Stars medic guys have some of those stats. I think they could pull some good stuff for them and say, well, we good had point. This many guys hurt in the whoops this year. Because they're keeping a log of all that and have been for
That's
years.
That's right. Didn't even think about that, but good point.
So, and he's not the only one. Garrett Marchbanks had a big one. Mm-hmm. I never heard what the final result was with him. Chris Blos had a big one that he was lucky to get away from. I don't know how he's not hurt. And then Austin Faulkner, obviously, this is the most painful one. Stabbed his knee. It looks like he did an ACL. He's going to try to ride it out. But with Chase Sexton riding as well as he is, I don't know how you go out there. Even as good as Austin's been, having as a guy who's blown out three ACLs, I don't know how you go out there and ride well enough to still win this title.
It's going to take this is going to be a really big test for him personally to be able to ride through the pain, to be smart. How is he going to handle it? It's a lot to handle for a young kid. Mm-hmm. And I feel for him. I know I've been a little critical about him in the past, saying I'm not sure if he's ready to win a title, things like that. I don't want it to end like this. I don't want it to be that commentator's curse, but he is still prone to mistakes and things like that. But he's going so fast. And now you got that situation. And I think every knee injury is different because there can be meniscus tearing. There could be joint issue. There might not be. It might just be a clean little pop. I rode for many, many years without an ACL. Mm. I just started wearing knee braces. So one thing he's pretty fortunate about is there's another weekend off, which doesn't happen in Supercross except once. So he's got that to let the swelling go down, but his knee's not going to get any better. New Jersey's going to be a tough one. It's going to really show his grit, and if he pulls this off, it's going to be pretty cool. I mean, he deserved it without a doubt, but it sounds like then he's going to get his knee fixed.
Either way, win or lose, he's out for the summer, which sucks.
Yeah.
But it was like a little bit frustrating to me because there was almost jokes, running jokes going that, he crashes in practice every weekend. And man, sure enough, he just was like bombing through those whoops. I don't know if it was just trying to get, and I've mentioned this before, I don't like that time qualifying because guys push so hard.
And you have this much time.
Yeah, you got this short amount of time. It's like, I've got to go fast.
Yeah.
And I don't know if he was trying to.
What do you do in place of that?
I like the racing. Yeah. Qualifying. Let the top 10 guys go right to the gate in their points positions.
Yeah.
And qualify everyone else. That's how it always was when
That's
I raced.
That's how it used to be,
I just preferred racing. I don't like watching people ride around, even if it is fast laps.
Well, that's interesting. I think you would probably minimize a lot of injury if they did that. You have the top 10 fastest guys trying to blow each other out.
I was just thinking of something. Now we're talking about it. When you watch that crash through the whoops, I watched it a couple of times. I'm like, it seemed avoidable, like maybe if he had rolled off, chopped the throttle.
It almost looked, not to plug the show, but he got a little bit of whiskey throttle as he got into there.
But
he
did.
Run off.
But I mean, hindsight is always easy, but I almost think that when he wheelied out of the whoops, the reason he didn't want to roll off is he was probably having a decent lap. And sometimes,
I'm not letting off. This lap time's too good.
With the qualifying being so short, you don't always have a perfect lap. So if you got everywhere and you came out and was a little sloppy, but you didn't really lose time, that's going to be potentially your fastest lap. Maybe that sort of led to him not wanting to shut off. So I don't know. Maybe if we get the chance, we could ask him what was going through his mind at that point. But it looked to me like he didn't want to give that lap away. Roll out of it.
You see riders kind of boasting, like, oh, qualified P1, you know. It's a pride thing for them.
Yeah.
And, man, it sucks to see a guy get hurt trying to put in a good fast lap for qualifying. It just seems stupid to me. Seems like
for
a waste.
For a gate pick, theoretically.
Well, anyway, we wish all these guys the best. Hope they heal up quickly and completely. Hate to see it this late in the season because then it does drag into your outdoor series.
Yeah.
I mean, hate to see it at all, but it is what it is. Last thing I want to touch on, completely not motor-related, but damn it, how good was it to see Tiger Woods come back and win? Did you watch any of that?
No, I was at MotoGP. So between Rossi leading and the place going ballistic there and then on the TV catching glimpses of it, two of the old guys had, in different parts of the country, the crowd on their feet. So I got to admit, I wrote Tiger Woods off too. I said he would never win again. So good on you, Tiger. That was pretty impressive.
I mean, if you watch where he came back from, just kind of having all kinds of pain and being hooked on pain pills. That whole debacle with him getting pulled over and arrested, that was tough to watch.
I feel like I could relate a little bit to him.
I mean, he came from a dark place, man, and just won the Masters.
And he looks fit.
Yeah.
Like, you can tell he trains his ass off. Yeah. Like, when he was there and he was cheering, I was like, yep,
was
that's a guy that does
You know what else was good is to see how generally happy he was that he won. I mean, it was just complete elation that he won. It wasn't like, okay, it's another one. It's just like,
and everybody too. All the top guys stayed and congratulated. It was cool. It was
Last time was 05.
Hey, maybe you guys could come back.
No. Yeah, maybe you can, Grant. Good luck.
What do you mean, at golf? No.
Anyway, congrats to him. That was one of the most impressive feats I've ever seen in sports, and it was really cool to see. I want to bring up our featured guest. Let's get to 11-time Baja 1000 champion Johnny Campbell up to the stage. He's brought to you by PowerDot. Go over to PowerDot.com and check him out. Get yourself one of these units. Look into the research and the studies that they've shown. This is a proven technology. It's not snake oil. It works. Whiskey Throttle at checkout gets you 20% off, so check him out. Johnny, welcome.
Yeah, thanks. It's really super great to be here and hang out with you guys and get to chat. The show is awesome. I've been watching all the episodes and stuff.
Cool. Well, thanks, man. I appreciate that. It means a lot. We're, we've talked about, we want to bring in all kinds of disciplines of racers, you know, road racers, off-road racers, supercross, motocross, truck, car, surfers. And we want to bring in athletes, anyone that's got a cool story. And you sent me earlier on your True Champion video. I did a DVD back in 08-ish.
Yeah, I kind of finished it around then.
And, man, it was good stuff. It was really cool to just kind of be able, because, you know, I didn't know those stories early on. It, as you know, it's tough to completely follow all the disciplines of racing. I obviously watched you win all these races all these years, but to go back and hear some of those early backstories and kind of what makes you you, it was really neat to see.
Yeah,
check
thanks.
Out True Champion if you're looking for a cool DVD. So tell us a little bit about where you grew up. You're a San Clemente guy, I learned in that video.
Yeah.
Which seems like an odd place for an off-roader to grow up.
Yeah, I was like a third-generation San Clemente. You know, my dad's family came from Nebraska in the 50s. And, you know, I remember my dad saying, oh, yeah, I remember being able to, you know, ride my bike or walk all the way through San Clemente in vacant lots, you know. And you think about that now, it's like, no way.
Can you imagine? Yeah, I mean, even so.
Imagine the guy back then going, you should buy the land here. It's going to be worth a lot. Yeah, whatever.
Yeah, no. I'm not going to waste my time with that. Real estate. Who can make money in that? But then in his era, that all of the Orange County hills, that was like the best riding back then, huh?
Yeah, you know, a lot of guys used to race or ride up in the tomato fields and then up by Dana Hills High School and stuff. Mm-hmm. There was some riding up in there and before all that started getting built up. And there was even a motocross track in San Clemente one time.
I heard about that.
Yeah, it was kind of where we called the tomato fields and up on the hill there.
Oh. Is that where Ray Somo rode to over there? Is that where he was riding?
Yeah, Ray did a fair bit of riding there.
I remember that.
Because he moved over to Capistrano Beach in that area and stuff back in the early 90s. Huh. Yeah, so I grew up, just south of the pier at T Street, and I surfed a lot and was never very good at it. And, you know, we ended up, my dad rode and raced some local Grand Prix and off-road races and stuff, and like an amateur level and whatever.
Okay. So he kind of piqued your interest in riding then, huh?
Yeah, you know, I grew up as a small kid going to the races all the time, and just, you know, it's all I wanted to do was just ride my bicycle at the races and eventually get a bike and ride and stuff. And so that finally happened, you know, when I was 9 years old. He brought home an XR75, and, you know.
A lot of guys' careers started on those bikes.
Yeah.
You got to look at a lot of guys. That were.
It's either PW50 or XR75.
Yeah.
Those were it.
Yep.
Yeah, and I remember the, you know, first day trying to let, you know, in the driveway. We lived in Capo Beach at that time, and it was just like right down the street from, like, the opening scene of On Any Sunday where the bicycles are. We live right down that street, so that was all that area. And but I remember talk about Whiskey Throttle, just like, okay, let the clutch out slow.
Yeah. Bam,
bam, down the street, boom, you know. So, yeah, it was pretty cool, and that started my riding right there.
I got to tell you, the pictures in that video, too, your dad had the most epic mustache. I love that thing.
Yeah, what happened
to
yours?
And this is a guy that appreciates a good mustache.
I do appreciate it. Yeah, it was time to I couldn't stand getting food in it anymore.
I don't know how you had it that long. I've tried before. I'm like, yep, I'm going to do it. And then, like, a week later,
It was impressive, for sure.
Yeah, well, it was
It was a definite talking point. Like, how many times people asked me when he was going to shave his mustache, and I was like, I'm going to tell him not to.
Yeah.
This is because we're getting this all riled up.
They either loved it or they hated it. But anyway, so how did you go from just kind of riding? Dad would take you out on the weekends. You'd kind of join him at these SRA or
yeah,
local races?
Yeah, you know, I started riding at 9 and then eventually got it like a CR80 around 1983. And
okay.
Took me to the I think my first race was at Carlsbad, and nice. At the Grand Prix there, we rode kind of like, you know, the old super bikers and stuff.
Yeah.
They rode like the TT course up there, some pavement, the old motocross track stuff.
Yes.
And so, yeah, that was my first actual race. It was like 1983, you know.
How old are you at this point?
I was 13.
Okay.
Would that have been your local track, Carlsbad, then, the closest one?
Yeah, closest one. It was a half hour away, and, you know.
What about Saddleback? Because would you have been almost in between those?
Yeah, exactly. And Saddleback closed in 84, so that was just right when I started racing.
Okay.
So I've been there, and I rode and stuff, but I never raced there.
Yeah.
I'm so bummed I missed Saddleback. And Indian Dunes.
Yeah.
Did you ever get to go to Indian Dunes?
I went to all these places as a kid. But I did get to race the Shadow Glen course, the one that crossed the creek and the GP stuff out there. And
there were two tracks there, International Track and the Shadow Glen track.
Really? Yeah. Where was this?
At Indian Dunes.
Indian Dunes. Up by Valencia.
Yeah, yeah, right behind Magic Mountain down the river valley there.
Right by Piru. So it's just
exactly.
Before Piru.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah, when we raced at Riverside Raceway, which is all a mall now, in Moreno Valley. Riverside, Carlsbad, Paris, Indian Dunes. I think that was kind of about it. I never raced at Saddleback. That closed shortly after. We did Sunrise. That was open, but it was all. And Glen Helen was
Paris. Was Paris
there.
Open?
Yeah, Paris was there, and we do 45-minute Grand Prix there too. They tied both tracks together and stuff.
That's a tight track for a GP.
Yeah, you know, 40. You go 45 minutes at a GP in the middle of summer, smoggy. Oh. You know.
Brutal.
So
you always kind of had a penchant for off-road then. The motocross thing was...
Yeah, and you know why? It was just the fact that I didn't really get to ride or practice. And at that time, you know, jumps started coming into play, the timing and everything. And so...
Suspension was getting better.
I'd go and try to ride motocross, but I didn't have enough practice to be able to, like, accelerate. So I go, I'm going to ride off-road because I like to ride. And I could go on the weekend and ride a whole bunch, you know, rather than show up at a CMC race in the novice class and do three laps, go home.
Sit there for 4 hours, wait for your next moto.
Yeah.
I know some of those events.
Yeah.
They'll wear you out just being there.
Yeah, it was tough. And then, you know, one of the pinnacle parts of my youth was when I was 15, 16, it's like, I really want to start racing a lot, you know, and. So my dad started kind of supporting me and taking me and stuff, and then he suddenly passed away when I was 16.
Gosh.
And that was like a big hit, you know, because my dad was my hero.
Yeah.
And, you know, he was a grading contractor in town and stuff, and so we worked in the dirt, we played in the dirt, you know, we surfed and stuff. But, it was a really challenging part.
And that was at a race, right?
Yeah, we actually went to it was another club called Double Cross Race, and they did like 45-minute GPs and stuff. We went to Glen Helen that day, and it rained, and it was, you know, perfect day. And he fell off the bike, and you know, to kind of back up of what happened was, you know, he was in Vietnam and was exposed to Agent Orange. Oh. He went through the whole cancer thing. And all the treatments and all that stuff back then kind of ruined his cardio.
Yeah.
And so at 39 years old, had a full cardiac arrest on the bike, fell off the bike, and
God dang
that was it.
From what you said in the video, you went over there and they were working him up and everything. I mean, that's traumatic.
Yeah. And, you know, I was just like, it was just so unexpected when you're 16, you know?
Yeah. And that's also, that's a really tough age. I can imagine. There's never a good age, obviously, but that's a tough one.
Rough.
Yeah. My brother was 12 and, you know, it was just like, it was just so unexpected, you know, that.
Yeah.
So then the challenge became, you know. My mom kept supporting my brother and I going to the races, and because she knew that was like a good outlet for us and that whole period of time and stuff. And so she supported us racing, and we just kept accelerating what we were doing and became expert before I graduated from high school.
You mentioned in your video too, you kind of had to grow up. I mean, obviously you're the older brother now, you're kind of the man of the house at 16.
Yeah.
Tough? I mean, is that...
Yeah, I think, you know, what was really, really special for us is that my dad, even when I was a kid, you know, he instilled like a really good work ethic in my brother and I. And so we worked. We worked hard. And every dime we worked after school mowing lawns or working at the local auto garage or whatever we were doing, you know, we put back into racing. We went racing. We, you know, hey, I got to buy a tire or got to buy a piston this week. And, you know,
racing's not cheap.
And the other, you know, another fun thing is that, not fun, but, you know, when my dad passed away, we had like three CR500s in the garage. And my dad was a big dude. He rode open bikes. I was 16. I rode 125 and 250s at the time. And so we're like, well, what are you going to do with these things? We're like, let's just ride them.
Yeah.
So at 16, I started racing a CR500.
Were you a big kid, you know, though?
No, not really. No? Okay. I was probably 150 pounds, just skinny.
On a CR500.
So the perfect build for a CR500
then.
Yeah. Okay.
And so, but, you know, this is all like a big precursor to, you know, moving to where I started my professional career, off-road racing on big bikes.
Yeah.
And so growing up, 150-pound kid, racing a CR500 at Carlsbad where there's no traction. So you learn throttle control.
Yep. That is
or you
that's
die.
One way. Yeah.
Those are your two options.
Yeah. Yeah. So so that all kind of was a precursor to starting to race XRs.
Huh. Yeah, that's crazy. who were some of the guys back then as you were 16 and really starting to say, okay, I want to do this? Who were the guys you looked up to, the racers?
Well, I really looked up to a lot of the motocross racers, you know, Ricky Johnson, David Bailey, Johnny O'Mara, and I was always kind of a Honda guy. There was a Honda shop in town, yeah. and so I guess my blood was really red from the beginning, yeah. But, you know, I looked up to those guys and followed the motocross and stuff as much as I could, but then, you know, I started doing off-road, so I also knew about guys like Bruce Ogilvie and Chuck Miller and Larry Rossler, you know, and all those guys were big heroes too, because, you know, and I started learning about like the Baja 1000 and I had a kind of a mentor in town, which was at the time my girlfriend's uncle. His name was Craig Adams, and Craig was like the fast guy at SRA and the fast guy at, you know, and he raced Baja and stuff, and so he kind of took me under his wing after my dad passed away, and, you know, showed me how to split cases and work on bikes and stuff. And so I kind of followed him, and he introduced me to Mexico. He had to go pre-run for the 1000, and I was like 17. He's like, yeah, come down and pre-run with me. So we go down there for a couple of days, and I'm like, I want to do this. This is awesome.
Yeah, you know, right away it clicked.
Like, just like, it's fast. It's your open desert. It's just bitching roads and sand washes and Mike Sky Ranch and all, you know, it's just like, it was incredible. And so
the speeds didn't scare you at all?
No, because in the Grand Prix, we grew up racing down drag strips and going fifth gear. So we're used to it, you know. We didn't have the jumps or, you know, the technique, but the speed, it was like, I don't mind going fast.
Because a lot of people, that's what freaks him out, is being wide open.
Yeah. That's me. I'm not interested.
Well,
in
I went to Baja, and I've done it with buddies, and I loved every minute of it. And we went at our own pace, but I was thinking, man, some of those washes and then these ravines, and then with the heat, sometimes you don't even see there's a drop off. I came to this one, I'm over. Anyway, had to get an underwear change after that, but it was like, I didn't expect that. It scared the crap out of me.
Well, that's. Yeah, we'll get to more of that, but that's the thing that gets me, is I not knowing what's coming up. That's the one thing I liked about a motocross track, is lines would maybe change, but you knew what was coming in front of you. And you guys are doing 100, not really knowing. It's crazy.
Yeah, it was kind of acquired a little bit, because even the Grand Prix were like repetitive, right? They were faster, but they're... And then I started racing some like local District 37 desert races, and that's where you started learning like the terrain reading. At high speed, you're going across a valley and stuff, and so
that's the skill set, right? Terrain reading,
exactly, and that's why you see, you know, even like motorcycle guys like myself have been in desert racing for a long time, and they transfer to like an off-road truck, and they're pretty good truck drivers because they know the terrain.
They're digesting what's coming towards them. Yeah,
that's crazy. That's interesting to me. Who was the first big sponsor you had? So you had your uncle. Was it your uncle?
Well, or yeah, we'll call him Uncle Craig.
Your wife's uncle, or right. At the time wasn't your wife yet.
Yeah.
And that's a cool story. We'll get to that too. Yeah. But
Uncle Craig.
Yeah.
So who was your first big sponsor?
So really, I didn't have like any sponsorship during when I was a amateur. You know, I had a guy that, you know, the local Honda shop gave me a discount or whatever and stuff. But, you know, I pushed hard. And once I broke into Baja, you know, I saw that Honda had an effort, you know, and I was like, oh, there's Ogilvy, there's Miller and Dan Ashcraft, and they were racing the XR. And I thought that was really unique because at that time, Kawasaki Team Green was a really big desert racing outfit, you know, and they had Paul Krause and Ted Honeycutt and Larry Rossler, you know, and then Hamill came up and, mm-hmm. and their effort was huge, and it was a benchmark. But, you know, I was a kind of a Honda guy, and I kind of watched how this small group of, you know, kind of a backdoor off-road effort through Honda. At that time, this was like 90, 89, 90, 91, you know, and I was like, ah, you know, I kind of like that underdog like effect, but man, they're racing a big old XR. What, yeah. You know, what is that? Why? Yeah. They have a CR500. Why?
Yeah.
You know, come to find out once I started building a relationship with Ogilvy and stuff is that, you know, he started teaching me Honda's philosophy. And at that time, you know, Honda's philosophy was the 4-stroke is Honda's off-road bike. 2-stroke is their motocross bike. And so they really divided
that. Why was that?
Well,
I mean, when you have the CR500 that could be easily adapted, why push the 4-stroke? I'm just curious. Did they give you an explanation on that? Or
because I believe in the 80s, Honda as a corporation and company grew so big that they had an automotive side. Where a lot of the other Japanese company manufacturers don't. And that auto side is looked at very closely by big government. And so Honda, wanting to be, you know, a green company and stuff, that they said, you know, 4-stroke is going to be our off-road bike. And so they made that policy early on. Mm. And
interesting.
So, yeah.
So you think the wheels were in motion way back then?
Yes.
For all of their motorcycles to go 4-stroke.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. It was. They first saw that a long time before it even happened.
That's crazy. The thing that it's like, why didn't they look at fuel injected 2-strokes? You can make those so clean now. Was that technology maybe not available?
I think a lot
yet?
Of it was just emissions back then. They realized that if we get a 4-stroke, they'll have more longevity in the off-road scene. Because think about a lot of the area now, it's very, very strict, you know, with spark arresters and having all the right tags and all that, and they're very hard on the manufacturers as well about
as we know, like California is like the strictest state on all this stuff. And so, you know, even now that I'm in part of the production development team and stuff, is that, you know, they're very stringent. You know, like now with the fuel injection, the bikes that get a green sticker or a street tag and stuff, no, you have to have a metal tank. You have to have a locked ECU. You can't tamper with it. You know, manufacturers have to go to far extents to make sure that the customer can't tamper with that. The reason being is the manufacturer will get fined if there's a way to, you know, break into that. So it's...
We can also thank Volkswagen for helping speed this all up as well.
Yes.
After they got busted, the motorcycle industry then had a lot of the attention put on them. And I remember the guys at KTM were just saying, it is so gnarly now. Like they were at a meeting and the guys said, if we figure out that you can unlock these ECUs, you guys are in some deep trouble. So everyone's watching their P's and Q's right now.
Yeah that'll sink a company. And then was it the law that was passed, your CARB or whatever?
Yeah.
That's the one that really...
California Air Resource Board,
They
they're a gem to deal with.
Yeah, they're sticky.
So was there a... You kind of mentioned seeing those Honda guys there. Was there a catalyst or a certain race or a certain time where something clicked and you're like, I can do this?
Yeah, I think, in 90... It was like 91, I rode all the score races. There's like 5 different Baja races. 2 of them were in the States, the Parker 400 and the Nevada 500. So I made me and my friends got together and we made an effort. We did all these races in the 250 class. I was still riding a CR250 two-stroke in that class at that time. And and stuff. But then at the Baja 1000, we had a really good ride going that year. And Baja 1000 is at the end of the year, in November every year. So, and at that time, Ogilvy had a pit program to where you can, you know, Honda, you, if you ride a Honda, you can pay them and they'll pit you. They'll supply fuel, spare parts and stuff. So it makes like a customer like, I want to do the Baja 1000. How do I do that?
Yeah, well, he doesn't have to go and form a team now. Yeah. He theoretically has a rented team.
Pay a fee and, you know, you bring your bike and you have emergency wheels and gas and stuff like that. So anyway.
Smart move.
So getting to that, some of the volunteers at Pitt were in the Hilltoppers Motorcycle Club, and I knew them from racing. And so they pitted me at a couple areas, and I was on my two-stroke. And my new Honda wasn't pitting two-strokes at that time. So we did pretty good, and so we were recognized by Honda at that time because we were the first finishing Honda because the factory bike had DNF'd. And so then shortly after that, you know, Ogilvy called me and said, hey, you guys want to ride? You want to ride a four-stroke? And yeah, let's meet. Yeah. And so so early in 92, that happened, and we went down and we actually rode one more 250 race, my brother, my friend David Onatoni, and myself, and we won the 250 class at the San Felipe 250 early in 92. And then is right after that is when Bruce called us and said, hey, let's do something.
Were those the events where Chuck Miller was referring to your bike as like well-worn? Or
yeah.
I don't want to say it was a pile of crap, but it was.
Well-worn.
It was, all our stuff was just clapped out. Yeah. We didn't have any money or support or anything.
But
you know?
But still, just riding off-road, like my EXE, I look at it, I'm like, it looks destroyed. I mean, when you really ride through all those different elements.
Oh, yeah, water,
chain,
rocks.
Sprockets, tires, dust. All that stuff doesn't last 5 minutes, it seems like.
Yeah,
if you're trying to look nice, it's one thing, but you kind of got to change it and go, yeah, that's a badge of honor. Look how used up my bike is.
Yeah,
yeah. Truly, that's how you got to look at it.
Well, that's how I'm going to look at it now, huh? Yeah. Your bike's hammered. No, it's a badge of honor.
Hey, I ride it.
I would have
ride.
Yes,
I would have never made it in the off-road world because I was always, even with my race bikes, I'd be like, oh, I don't even want to ride this thing. It's too nice, you know.
Yeah.
If it was a mud race, I'm like, should I just ride my practice bike?
Yeah.
I was too nice to my stuff. So I want to go back to, this was before you kind of linked up with Honda. In the video, you talk about this Nevada rally that you went and did, and it was your first rally where you're actually trying to read a scroll that's a whole nother skill set. And it's been fun watching Andrew Short try to learn that. They just go out in the desert and I don't even know what they do, plot points and try to get to them or whatever. But, that was a really cool story to me. Have you heard about this? Tell the story about it.
Okay. So like in the early 90s, there was, I did have help from Honda at that point when that came up, but from 93 to 95, Franco Acerbis, the plastic manufacturer, mm-hmm. who is one of my dear friends, he came over and linked up with Casey Folks, the late Casey Folks, who was, formerly Best in the Desert. He puts on Vegas Torino and that stuff.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So he linked up with them, and they go, hey, we're going to introduce rally racing to America. Because in the U.S., even still today, people don't understand what rally racing really is. You know, they go, oh, Baja or whatever. But it's a totally different game. The bikes are different. The navigation's different. So in rally racing, you don't know the course. You don't have a map of the course. You don't have a track log of the course. Everything you have is on your road book. So your road book is you have a road book holder that's a scroll, and it's an electronic scroll, so you have a toggle switch to advance it, right? So you have a mileage on one side. You have a tulip note showing like an intersection or a mountain or something in the picture, and then maybe there's some other notes on the right. So what you do is you match your mileage on your odometer with that notation on your road book, and as you go, okay, hey, look, there's a left turn in 100 yards. Okay, there's a left turn, and you advance it, and you go, okay, what's next? You go, okay, in 2 miles, there's a right turn, and it goes over a hill, and there's a notation, and it shows you that. So there's no ribbon. There's no arrows on the course. But these guys are doing it at 100 miles an hour.
Yeah.
You know,
this is like the Dakar type. Yeah.
Correct. Right. And this Nevada rally was the same way, except in the early 90s, it was very elementary. we weren't using like electronic devices to help navigation.
Yeah, are they checking? Didn't you have to roll the scroll with your hand?
Yeah. I thought they were manual at one point.
At one point they were, but even in the 90s it was electronic.
Okay.
So you had like a toggle switch on your bar, and so you can advance it. You know, as your mileage rolled off, you can, okay.
So are there checkpoints too, where if you miss a check, you're disqualified or anything like that on the rallies?
Back in those days, there was actual physical checkpoints. Now there's some checkpoints, but a lot less because everything's done
digitally,
electronically, and they have tracking devices, so they know exactly where you go and stuff. But yeah, so the Nevada rally, I was introduced to that. The first year I couldn't go. The second year, Ogilvy says, hey, he goes, I got an extra bike. I want you to go learn how to do this. I had no idea how to navigate. I was looking at book, and I was like, I was completely lost, right? So,
as many of us would be.
So the riding and everything, and these are staged races. Like a Baja is a continuous race from green flag to checkered flag.
Yeah.
Through the night, whatever it takes to get there, right? These are staged, much like
Tour de France.
Tour, yeah. Exactly. Yeah. And it's actually the same organization that puts Tour as they do Dakar, ASO.
Okay.
Yeah. But so you do stages. So each day is 300 miles, 500 miles, whatever the stage is. So in the Nevada rally, I was new to it. And so you try to follow tracks and you're trying to kind of get a handle on how all this works. And I'm getting lost and stuff. And so I'm, you know, had the canny sense to kind of follow some of the fast guys. And I was get lost and this and this. But halfway through the thing, I found myself in second overall. And I was like 23, 24 years old or whatever, new to this style of racing. And there were some much better rally racers that were behind me. But there was a very wise Frenchman who had a lot of experience. His name was Alain Olivier. And he was riding out front. And he knew he couldn't ride away from me. You know, and we start like one bike every 2 minutes or whatever. So you can't. But I can catch up to him, you know, as he's navigating and stuff, and just sit on him and follow him. So as you probably saw in the video, one day we took off and we had changed my wheel, and my wheel sensor to give me my mileage wasn't working properly.
Oh, boy.
This doesn't mean that I'm not even using that as an excuse of what happened that day, because I was a total rookie at this. So Alain Olivier, you know, the night before, he for sure looked at the road book and said, we're going to pull a fast one on Johnny here because I can't ride away from him. So he blew the corner where we were supposed to turn left. He went up knowing that I would just follow his dust or follow his track, and he got off the side of the bike like he's working on it, and then I just rode right by him. I go, oh, I must be leading now. You know, so
now then, what do I do?
So then I'm like, oh, okay, this turn looks like it's lining up with the map. Yeah, that. And pretty soon I'm like on top of this hill, right? And I see dust across the valley where I was supposed to go, right? And I'm like, I'm totally lost, you know? So I find roads and trails, connect back, catch back up with the race. But this time I'm like back in ninth or tenth or whatever. And then it was just a chase of dust to finish. And so right there, I kind of blew my chance at winning the rally, but I didn't have the experience of navigation to really win it anyway. I didn't deserve to win it.
He was pretty smart. I mean, that's pretty cheeky what he did there. But at the same time, I think that makes you really realize very quickly, all right, I'm figuring this out quick.
Yeah. So after, were you mad at that guy? Or were you like, all right, you got me. Like, I don't know. I didn't know how to feel. Like, oh, you crafty bastard.
But at the same time,
it's like, well, you could just do that to anybody. You could just, all right, this guy's a good navigator. I'll follow him. I don't even need to look at my book.
Yeah.
And then we get to the last little stretch where I can see the home stretch. I'll just blow past him and beat him.
Yeah. And so he was a wise rally racer and experienced, and I wasn't. And so he did that. So that gave him the gap and the cushion for the last couple of days. And so I wasn't able to recover that. But it was a huge life lesson to me.
Whole
rally lesson. You know, so the next year we came back, we freaking practiced. We made our own road books, and we all traded them and did our own. We trained, you know, and so the next year I came back, and it was like clockwork. Boom, 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 and I was able to win. So that was like my introduction to rally racing those 2 years. I got second and then first. And then I had some opportunities to go to the Dakar after that. And that was 95 to, you know, yeah, that was like 95. But I never really took the opportunity because my Baja career at Honda was elevating, right? I was every year we were doing good and I wanted to win Baja and that was my focus. So fast forward to the year 2000 and the Nevada rally had ceased. Franco only did it like 3 years. And so then we ended up, Casey Folks put on this race. It was similar to a rally, but it was all marked. So it was like a 6-day stage race around the state of Nevada. So Franco at Sherby's came over and he came over to watch and, you know, he's in the helicopter watching the race and stuff. And we had developed a big relationship, you know, and stuff over the years. And so then on the fourth day, he goes, if you win this race, I'm taking you to Dakar. You know, I'm like, all right. But the problem was Destry Abbott was leading, you know. Well, that next day or that night, I got really sick, food poisoning or whatever. I'm like, oh my gosh, I can't race. I can't do this. And so Destry went out first and then he crashed. So then I led and the final two stages, I didn't win those stages, but I got the lead in the rally then or that race.
Had enough of a cushion.
Yeah. So at the finish of the Nevada 2000, Franco Cherbys goes, you're going to Dakar, I'm taking you. So 2001 Dakar, which was the true Paris to Dakar.
Yep.
You know,
I used to watch it all the time. And you guys would have to catch the ferry across to North Africa.
Yeah.
It's pretty interesting when you actually look at the route and where they went and all the countries. It was insane, actually.
Really amazing. And there's a South African guy, you know, Alfie Cox.
Yep. Good friend of mine too. Yep. Yeah, he's like the mayor of off-road racing from South Africa. He did it many a time.
Yeah.
I remember hearing a lot of his stories. They also got hijacked and held at gunpoint and robbed and all kinds of crazy stories.
Is that why they moved it? Because it was just through such dangerous areas?
Yeah, in 2008, I think they ended up postponing the race altogether because they had some French tourists got jacked down there or something, so they moved it. And I think they already had, like, in negotiations with South America, and then they moved it all down there.
Weren't they also flying people, like, over the Sudan and stuff and just all kinds of stuff like
that? Yeah, so Jimmy Lewis is also a good friend of mine. He was at factory BMW doing it back then. And so the one race, I think it was Dakar to Cairo that year. And they had to go, there was a big terrorist threat in Niger. So they ended up coming in with those huge Russian cargo planes, putting the whole rally in those things, moving the whole rally over Niger into Algeria. Or no, Libya. No, it was Libya. And so, you know, Jimmy's all sketched because he's like, I don't think I'm supposed to be here as an American, you know.
Yeah, I can imagine. But
he won a stager, right? Or third in a stage?
He won a few stages in Dakar. Yeah. And I think his best overall was like third.
Yeah,
it was like 99 or 2000 finished.
I remember that bike. He would go out and ride all the way from here to Vegas.
Yeah.
Did you ever have any sketchy moments?
No real sketchy moments. Africa was interesting, though. I mean, it was a culture shock. Once I crossed over the ferry from Spain, you know, to Morocco, you're just like, oh my gosh, there's guys.
We're not in Kansas anymore.
Yeah. Weird music and guys wearing, you know, sheets and different things. And you're just like, whoa, you know. And then, you know, that year went through Morocco, Mauritania, which is really a poor country. And then into Mali, and then into Senegal. So it was crazy because once you cross from Mauritania and you go to Mali, then you go to Black Africa, and everything's like real colorful, and all the, you know. So you go from like an Arabic state to a Black state.
Mm. Yeah.
So it's really, crazy, really interesting.
And how did you do? You were like eighth or something?
Yeah. So Franco ended up making a deal with his moto club in Bergamo, Italy. And they rounded up an XR650R from Dellara, who was an Italian importer, Honda importer. Because I have to ride a Honda because I'm, you know, factory Honda guy. And so I rode basically a box stock XR 650, and I finished eighth overall, and they called me first rookie or whatever that was, you know.
And that's a way underpowered bike, right? I mean, everybody's running.
They had twin cylinder BMWs and a KTM. I'm not sure if they had the twins then or not, but they had, you know, they had high horsepower 650s. Yeah. And
that was around the time when KTM really sort of
started going. Yeah. They started advancing.
They put a lot of effort into that kind of racing.
You could have raced the Trans Alp.
I'd still be there.
Yeah. Yeah, that's crazy to me to be going that fast in places you don't know at all. At least Baja, you've seen before, you know the terrain.
Yeah, you're pre-running.
You're in a place you've never, ever seen, and you're trying to read a book.
I remember one stage.
It's like having a laptop.
And in the back of your mind, you know that you could be held at gunpoint as well or something along those lines. So, like, these elements.
It was no joke because there's one section where, like, between Morocco and Mauritania, those countries are always, like, kind of fighting.
Yeah.
Well, there's this one area where they told us the night before, do not go outside the rock cairns. And there's a section of road where there's rock cairns. And it's because it was mines.
Oh, yeah. Let's just throw that in the mix, too.
I'm just trying to find my way through the desert.
Yeah.
Oh, there's mines. You know, pretty crazy.
No, thanks.
That's nuts to me. Like, you almost, I don't know if I could prepare myself for all of that.
Listen, it takes a lot of bravery to me. That whole thing, you've got to be a very adventurous person and just be like, all right, bring it. Like,
and
I'm ready.
You've got to have large attachments. Some seriously large attachments.
Yes, yes, you do. Talk a little bit about Chuck Miller and Bruce Ogilvie. For those that don't know, they're longtime Honda. I mean, Chuck is now pretty high up the ladder over there. But but go back to where they began and kind of how they helped you and.
Yeah, you know, early 92, end of 91, I started talking with Bruce a little bit and getting to know him. And I knew him from, you know, he won Baja and, you know, he's kind of an off-road legend and stuff. But he's kind of a quiet guy and stuff. But he was really, really, really organized and really smart guy. So anyway, he took me under his wing at that point and said, he goes, okay, I'm gonna give this kid with a bunch of, he has some raw talent, but he doesn't know how to set up a bike. He doesn't know crap. He's just riding these stock clapped out CRs, right? So anyway, I remember meeting him out at his house in Riverside, his little, you know, block house he had out there, and he said, hey, come on out. We're gonna work on an engine. Okay. So I go out there and we talked all day, and he showed me all the workings of an XR motor. Basically, we split the cases, went through the tranny, did the valves, did everything. And from that point on, he really he took on the role of my mentor. And so I just followed his footsteps, you know, whatever he said, I did, and saw how he went about his racecraft and his logistics. And I mean, Bruce would build a plan for an army to go down to Mexico and, you know, dotted every I, crossed every T, and with whatever resource he had, he did such a phenomenal job. And so, you know, so I stayed close to Bruce, and so about 94, I was working as an auto mechanic, racing on the weekends for Bruce and stuff. But then he's like, hey, he goes, the only way I'm going to be able to pay you to be a racer is I need you to come help me because our program is so small. I need you to come to the shop, start building race bikes and start, you know, doing sponsor stuff and start. So I'm like, oh man, I don't know. I'm, you know, making a whole $300 a week.
Where
here.
Were you working as an auto mechanic?
So I was, a friend of mine, in San Clemente owned Shade Tree Automotive. And so when I was in high school, I worked there after school, you know, and then they taught me a lot about mechanics and cars and different things. And it was a great job.
What were you doing? Just like brake jobs and.
Yeah, it was Volkswagen. So I started with just pulling bug motors out and splitting, you know, breaking down greasy bug motors and, you know, cleaning up parts and sweeping trash cans. Started as a 16-year-old kid doing that stuff, you know, and then built my way up. And then so I was, so anyway, I was doing service work, you know, whatever it might be. And then Bruce goes, but I really wanted to be a racer, you know, I wanted to get paid to be racing. And so the first couple years, you know, it was just like, hey, bikes, parts, here, come race with us, you know. And then he's like, hey, come work in the shop and start doing this for me so I can, because Bruce's main job then was senior product evaluator. So he worked with Honda R&D. He was American Honda's eyes and ears Honda R&D.
Okay.
So he was basically the guy at that point in time that could say yes or no to a model, you know. And
so crazy, huh? And that sometimes it can come down to one person's decision of whether that's going to come here or not, yeah, and I'll go into production.
Yeah, and he was a phenomenal evaluator. Like, I don't know anybody like him, you know. I think maybe, like, Dre Dirks, who works for Honda R&D still, is...
It's an Arizona boy.
Yeah, he worked with Bruce quite close at that time, too, and Dre's still there, and he's really good. But anyway, so Bruce's main job was that, and, like, 20% was kind of this little off-road program, you know, and with not a lot of zeros behind it. And so let's hire Johnny Campbell, this 24-year-old kid, you know. And at that time, Eric Krippa was our technician, and then they kind of had him move more toward press and doing that type of stuff. And so I started working in the shop with Eric Krippa. So Eric taught me a lot about the bikes, and he's a phenomenal genius, eccentric, you know, guy.
I worked with him in the media side of things after he kind of left the off-road. So
exactly.
Best sandwich maker in the business.
The best.
For sure.
Assembly line sandwiches. So.
You're going to be remembered for something. Make sure it's your sandwiches.
I love Eric. So.
Well, he's also known for not making being the best picker of women in his life.
Oh, boy.
well, we could stop there.
Yeah.
I do know some stories, but... But, good old Eric. But so we worked in the shop together at Honda, door number 7, you know, two doors down from the race team and stuff. And so we, you know, and that's, I started basically building the bikes, testing the bikes, racing the bikes. And then, you know, I had
a partner. That had to be a dream, right, to go from a car shop to, I'm working at factory Honda.
It was a dream, except I commuted from San Clemente to there.
What
Bruce got my foot in the door, and we had a great senior manager named Gary Christopher at the time, and he really went to work and got me in the door, you know. And I was making $14 an hour in the shop, you know, commuting 50 miles one way a day, but you know, I was doing exactly what I wanted to do, you know. And so I, you know, started building the race bikes, and we'd go race with our volunteers, and we just, Bruce kept like, and myself, we kept elevating the program, and you know, so yeah, and so that's kind of my relationship with Bruce. Was he was you know, my mentor, my dad, my everything.
Yeah.
I listened to him, and he was like a general in the army, you know.
Yeah.
And then like Chuck Miller at the time was actually, he was on the team, so he rode, he was still racing at that time, you know. And Chuck's a super fun guy. He came from racing District 37 Desert, you know, and became Bruce's partner. And Bruce kind of brought him along. And then Bruce kind of, you know, he stopped racing. But Chuck and Dan Ashcraft were like the main racers. And then Bruce brought me into the program. And so I went pre-running with Chuck. So he taught me how to pre-run and what to look for. And so we rode a lot together and rode enduros together and desert races. And you know, and then Chuck, you know, kept elevating himself at Honda through the whole system, and now he's a senior manager and on the service side, so he's, you know, he's done multiple jobs there, from started as an ATC racing mechanic, you know, ATC.
They move you around over there. It's so weird. You only get a few years in a spot, and then they say, okay, you're going to go here now.
Yeah,
you don't have a choice.
So he did Honda Riders Club of America, went to the race team, managed that for a long time. He did product evaluation for a long time, did sales, was his, you know, last job. And then finally, this next move, they moved him into more of the service side, you know, dealer networks and stuff like that. So, but yeah, Chuck and I, we get along great, and we're good family friends and stuff. And
if I'm not mistaken, a lot of people aren't big Chuck Miller fans, right?
I don't know.
That's a kind of
I'm
vibe.
I'm a huge Chuck Miller fan.
Yeah, no, I know. I get that. I'm just saying. I thought. Anyway, maybe I'm off base here. Johnny's devastated. No, it's my buddy.
It's my
but
guy.
I heard. Yeah, I just thought that he was someone that was kind of known. Either you got along with him or you didn't.
I always did. He was, you know, I would deal with him at the race team for a little bit there, and even when I rode for FMF Honda, he was at Honda. So
yeah,
he was always a great guy.
Yeah, he's always been nice to me.
Yeah,
really.
Yeah,
nice,
and
actually.
He's one of the you know, at one time there was a lot of really a lot of racing enthusiasts kind of in the corporate structure over there at Honda. You know,
yeah.
A lot of them have just gotten old and retired, and you know, taken their severance and gone away, and they've mm-hmm. done a good job and stuff. And so, you know, now there's a new group, a new blood, and stuff like that. So Chuck's one of the old school guys that's
yeah.
still there, that still knows what it was like back in the day, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
He's seen Honda through its heyday and
for yeah. sure. Yeah. In the struggles and now. So.
Yeah. And now tell us what happened with Bruce. Cause I don't know how many people really know that story.
Yeah. So around, it was 2007, Bruce developed a synovial sarcoma, which is a really aggressive cancer.
Oh, geez.
And he fought that for 2 years. And at that time, it was an interesting time because it was always kind of like the not talked about and, you know, known that Johnny's going to take over the race team someday. You know, there was glimpses of it, you know. And so I was under Bruce for 17 years. And so right about kind of when I started going, gosh, what's the next move? I was 36, 37, going, okay, I've almost accomplished all my goals racing. What am I going to do, you know? Mm-hmm. And we all go through those stages,
for sure.
You know, as professional racers. And so fortunately, Bruce had brought me through the Honda system and taught me some management skills, some organizational skills, and you know, my biggest asset was I knew so much about Mexico, really, you know, and Bruce had gotten me, you know, him and his volunteers had put myself and my race partners to a certain, you know, level. I mean, we won a lot of stinking races over the years.
Yeah.
And, but yeah, so Bruce, was fighting this illness, and I was kind of like, gosh, what do I do? And I could do schools, I could do a dealership, I could do all the stuff. So I did a bunch of research and stuff, and I go, you know what? I've been groomed to really take this position, and I knew Bruce was tired, even in the midst of if he knew he was sick or not at that point.
But yeah.
So I built a proposal to basically say, you know what? I'm going to take the team under a label under JCR, under Johnny Campbell Racing, and I want to see if this is a good way for the program to go. And so Bruce gave me his blessing. At that point, Chuck was in the race team management role and stuff, and so we were able to, you know, get that past management at the end of 07. And so in 08, we opened the doors to Johnny Campbell Racing.
And talk about timing. That was that's right when the recession hit.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you managed to pull that off, huh?
So fortunately,
contracts were done before the shit hit the fan.
Before
that's what I was
going
to say.
Went like that, everything was done. And Honda's been so gracious to me. Like,
that's cool.
Over the years. Yes, budgets are radically different than they were back
sure.
in 07 and even 08 and 09 when things really tanked. They really were so faithful to taking care of Johnny Campbell that it's amazing. I've been able to hang on and do the race team for 10 years, you know, and I couldn't have done it, obviously, without their support. And I wouldn't have wanted to do it without Honda support because I'm such a family guy, yeah, you know.
It would be strange not to see
yeah.
your team on red.
Yeah. So anyway, Bruce ended up passing in April of actually 10 years ago, 2009, and it was really, really a tough time, and it's still tough, you know.
Yeah.
Still
yeah.
get emotional about it.
Well, like you said, he was
he's so integral in my career.
Yeah, you just wouldn't be where you were without that guy.
No, not at all.
So,
it's funny because all your different experiences, like you said, it set you up at the right time, at the right place. To take the team to that next level, and you got the mechanical mindset, you've got the experience as a racer, you've got some, you know, you worked at, you know, motors, you know, you kind of had the whole package.
And especially when one thing you have to do, at least it seems, I'm just looking from the outside in, you've got to be very organized, like you said. And Bruce was like that, where he planned it out and he had everything covered.
Yeah.
And for those big, you know, Baja events, you have to. You can't just wing it.
Yeah. You got a 1,000 mile of race course, and you got, you know, 25 pit stops, 25 pit crews, and you're doing a pit service, you know, and we were pitting up to 40, 50 teams sometimes.
Jeez.
So each pit crew would be carrying about 120 gallons of fuel, you know, and all these pit spares down the peninsula. And it was a remarkable program that he had built and then I carried for a lot of years, you know.
So. That's still not going?
So we'll fast forward to that, but it's
we'll get there.
Yeah,
we'll
get there.
one thing that I didn't know back then, I didn't tell, I just learned it watching your videos, those pit crews are not paid. They were just volunteers that were down there.
Yeah.
Diehard fans.
Literally. I thought for sure they were on staff somehow or at least paid.
No, they were family, friends, Honda employees, Hilltoppers Motorcycle Club, Desert MC, just, you know, guys that Bruce had brought along that, you know, for years and had built this big old army.
Yeah.
You know, we call it BO's army.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, it was amazing, you know, how it all worked and the good years and stuff.
Well, take me through the story. I thought this was great too. I didn't know how you and your wife had met. And I thought it was just like hilarious that you've got a note from her when you guys are like 5 or 6 or something.
Yeah.
She wrote some little hand note. You know, I like you. I think you're cute. She spelled cute wrong. I mean, it's like written in crayon. Yeah. It's written in crayon.
Well, at 5, 6, you do write in crayon.
Anyway.
Yeah. So tell us that story. So our parents knew each other from the races and whatnot. And, you know, her uncle was kind of like the fast guy in town in San Clemente at that point in time and stuff. And so the families, sometimes we go camping at the desert together and whatever. And so I knew Faye at the races when we were kids, right, when we were little. And I remember one time we went up to visit. So they had moved a couple different places. They landed in Hesperia of all places at one point in time, but we went up to go and I was riding XR75 just like that. And she had one as well. And so we were riding in a dirt lot next to her house in Hesperia when we were like 8 and 9 years old. And, so anyway, we always kind of had this connection, and then they moved back down to San Clemente when she was in junior high. So we started actually dating I'd heard that she had a crush on me like when she was a freshman. And so I'm like, hey, you know, let's go out or whatever. And so I think our families went to the desert then. And then she's like, oh, I have a hard time getting to the bus and going to school, whatever. I'll come pick you up. It was like freaking all the way across town, right? But so she was 15, I was 16, you know, her parents let her go out with me when I had a van, you know, and
that's trusting parents right there.
They're like, oh, we know the Campbells are a good family. It's like, oh, he's still a dork. So, but anyway, so we started dating and she was sensitive to the motorcycles. I mean, there was times where a lot of weeks where she'd go, okay, I'm coming over. Okay, come over. I'm going to work on dirt bikes till midnight. Yeah. She'd just go and watch TV with my mom. Or sit on the deep freezer in the garage.
Didn't bother. She
grew up around it, so she got it.
Yeah.
And then she also started racing when she was a teenager as well. I mean, she raced like an XR200 and CL125, and she was all into it. And kind of a big pinnacle of her career was the Adelanto Grand Prix. Always had a big mud hole jump. So her climax to her career was, I'm going to race Adelanto, I'm going to jump the mud hole on her XR200, right? So she did it. It was about 95. She did it, and she pulled it off. So
yeah, wow. That was her Caesar's Palace.
Yeah. After that, the racing kind of subsided, and then we had kids. And and now we just dual sport. So
she does still ride with you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We went through a hiatus where she didn't ride much, you know, just growing up with the kids and whatever. And now it's like, now we got all these great like dual sport bikes and stuff, and she rides dirt really well. And
that's
and
cool. Everything.
So we do adventure rides, and you know, some Honda Media stuff together. Yeah. But yeah, we just did a 67 mile ride on Saturday, you know, from our house in Murrieta out the wine country, back around. Nice. Up in Duluth, ate lunch at the golf club there. And
oh, that's cool.
So,
that's great.
So now we have a good time doing that. And now my kids are almost all out of the house. So.
17 and 19, you said?
Yeah. Yeah.
One more year.
Yeah.
I mean, that's you too again.
I know. It's crazy.
So how many years have you guys been married?
26.
That's freaking awesome.
26. Man. Yeah, we got married. I think I had just started riding for Honda. It was like 90. It was 93. And so we were young. We were like 21, 20, you know, something like that. But we had already been together like 6 years through high school and stuff. And so we just, it was just easy, you know.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So we were best friends.
That's a goal not many people get to anymore, man. It's something to be really proud of. You mentioned your faith, your Christian faith, kind of played a big part in that.
Yeah.
Did you guys both grow up in a Christian home, or?
Yeah, you know, she grew up Catholic, and I was Christian and stuff, and then she started, you know, going with me to youth group and whatever and stuff, and so I think that's why her parents trusted me. And stuff like that.
He was smarter than we think he is. He's like, I'll just take it to Bible study in my van that's got curtains.
And never mind that blacked out window.
Yeah.
And the rest of the story, we don't need to talk about those details. But
yep, that's right. It was Bible study.
But yeah, my faith has always been a big part of my life. And I think that really, really what helped carry me and my family through my dad's passing and the motivation and assurance of going and taking the risks that we do, you know, and going, you know, I could die, you know, well, where are you going?
Yeah, no kidding.
You know, what happens after that, you know? And so it was just a true reality to me of, you know, Christ and what God sent his son to, you know, die for us. And 'cause we can't save ourselves. If you look at us, we're a bunch of clowns, you know. You know, and he knew that, and that's why, you know, I live that way, and you know, and believe that. So.
Yeah, you know, you'll get people saying that Christians are hypocrites; they're still sinning or whatever. And it's like, well, I know that's why I need Jesus, right?
Yeah,
like, that's
exactly. It's like we're so far from perfect, any one of us, you know, and so it's like, yeah, there's hypocrisy everywhere, you know. I'm probably guilty of it for sure, you know, but we try to live our lives just down to earth and love people as Jesus would love you.
Yeah. Yep. Amen, man. I love it. That's awesome. All right, tell me about the XR600. That was a big machine.
Yeah.
And you were the man. Like, you, when I think of that bike, I think of you in the desert. And who was the guy that raced the GNCCs on that thing?
Scott Summers.
Scott Summers. I was thinking Russell Summers.
Yep.
And he was a big man, too.
Yeah. Our careers kind of paralleled a little bit. He was a little bit before me, and then I came on. And so Honda had a really strong, like, off-road effort in the 90s into the 2000s.
Yeah.
With Scott on the East Coast and us on the West Coast. And it was, you know, and like I mentioned before, the precursor was me as a skinny teenager on a CR500 in Carlsbad.
Yeah.
You know, well, I kind of knew how to ride big bikes. Mm. You know, I had to, because that's what I had, you know.
Yeah.
Didn't have any money to get anything else. But so that was a challenge when I came to Honda was Bruce. I was still trying to ride my two strokes at the same time, go to Baja races and ride the four stroke. Mm-hmm. And at that point in time, the bikes were so radically different than a motocross bike and that bike. So your timing was really off and different. You're riding the four stroke completely wrong. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that Bruce did to me was he challenged me. He said, park your two strokes. He goes, in 6 months, you'll be faster than you are on your two strokes if you stick to the four stroke. I'm like, all right. So, you know, so he challenged me. So I started racing Grand Prix. I rode some even motocross races. I rode all district desert racing, all in this XR, and really learned the bike and learned the weak points, learned where you can actually make traction and stuff. And so, you know, I learned that bike. It was my bike. I just rode it everywhere. It was a big, heavy bike. But, you know, nobody could beat me on a Carlsbad Grand Prix. You know, there's no traction there, but I knew how to make traction. Yeah. You take guys like Hamill and Zitterkoff and, you know, Kraus and a lot of the off-road guys that show up on KX500s at Grand Prix at Carlsbad.
They couldn't hang. Yeah.
You know, and they're just like, what the heck? And it was just all learning throttle control and that bike and everything. But then again, me racing them in like a local desert race or whatever, then I had really the deficit on that bike because it was heavy and there's a lot of whoops and, you know, the chassis was just moving around like this. And, you know, you go down in a G out and it's like, I could break second gear in the XR 600 if I wanted to. I just go, okay, I'm going to break second gear. I'll hit the bump this hard.
Oh,
and
really?
And it would break it.
Really? You know? Why?
Well, because if you step back to the XR 500, that bottom end and that tranny was all built around a 35 horsepower XR 500.
Yeah. Okay.
And then they moved up to a 600. We punched them out to 628 with a different cam. And so it was easy to like go, boom, and break it. So you had to learn those limitations of that bike, you know.
You're back into the 70s where it was like bike management.
Yeah. It was bike managed. So go fast where you can really race this bike, use the advantages, and where it was not good, just survive.
So what would break it? Like downshifting hard or accelerating hard? But or
too much load?
Yeah, like say, you know, how you get on the gas before you land off, before you hit the ground on a jump. You would land, and it was just like, boom. You know, because all that torque and power.
You couldn't harden the gears.
It was the second gear on the main shaft, and so we used to actually take the second gear on the main shaft out of the XR 650L, the same bike that's been around forever. It had shorter teeth, mm-hmm. and it had one less tooth, but it still worked. So it was a stronger gear. So we'd throw that thing in there.
Were they doing any treatments to it, like tumbling and hardening and cryo and all that stuff? Was that even around?
Not for all the local bikes and stuff. On our Baja bikes, we actually had factory crankshafts, factory transmissions, in which the transmissions were actually four speeds because all the gears were built up.
Oh, nice.
So we didn't have first gear.
Oh, is that right?
In Baja, we didn't need it.
I was going to say, you probably didn't need it at the speeds you're going. just out of the pitch, a little more clutch loop.
Yeah.
Guys pushing you to get you going. Yeah. Huh, that's crazy. What else were those race bikes like?
Well,
I mean, what were some of the other features of it?
When I first started, the years I first started in with Honda, they were building a lot of horsepower into those XRs because they were trying to compete against the KX500s. And so we were having a lot of failures because they were never designed for that much power. Right. So the number one biggest problem, well, there was a few. Can't say number one, but heat. Heat was the number one culprit because they were air-cooled, and we couldn't get rid of the temperature. You know, we'd build fins on the cylinder heads, or we'd run a massive oil coolers. But the problem is, like, when you're, like, tapped out, those bikes are making the most power, the most heat, and so the things would just lay down. They just slow down, or the crankshaft would blow at the bottom or whatever. And
in the middle of nowhere, you're like,
the stators would just, the solder joint on the stator would just go away. Mm. It was just too hot.
So did they never make them liquid cooled?
In the late 90s, we started development on the XR650R.
Okay.
And how much did you have to do with that? How much did you have to do with developing that bike?
Well, Bruce and Dre and those guys did most of the development in the late 90s. And then, like on the XR, knowing that they got to get Johnny a bike that he can race the whole race on without the thing slowing down, right? And that meant going water cooling. So they brought me in to do, you know, some jetting and some final suspension settings and stuff. But Bruce was still really sharp at that point in time, and so he did most of the development on the XR650R.
That was a good bike.
That catapulted my career, you know, because up to 99, from 92 to 99, I was on the XR600, and we started at horsepower up here, and by the time 99 rolled around, I was riding almost a stock XR600 because I knew I could hold the thing wide open the whole time, and it wouldn't slow down, even though it started off slower.
Yeah.
You know, but once, like in 97 or 98 when they were developing the XR650R, which came out in 2000, the end of 99. The first time I rode that motor, I told Bruce, get me this motor, I'll win every race. And, you know, it took a couple years to get the chassis right on that thing. And once they did, and I got that bike, and, you know, Steve Hengeveld was my race partner at that time. Once we got together, it was just like, we knocked out every race we went to, we won. Mm. Whether it was Tonopah 300 or Nevada this or Baja that. It's like, we just went on a tear with the XR650, you know, because it had a cooling system.
Yeah. Well, I can't imagine trying to keep an air-cooled bike hot for however long the Baja 1000 lasts.
Yeah.
In whatever the temperatures are. It's not cold down there. That thing probably ran like a KX60 by the time
it was so, like Jimmy Lewis and I rode in 95. It was Tijuana to La Paz, and Cowie had their effort, and they had all the, you know, a great effort and stuff, and I was riding, I built the bike like an XR628, and it was kind of a mild motor. Okay, this will live, this will work. But, you know, 300 miles in, the thing's detonating itself apart, you know. And I ended up nursing it, got it to Jimmy. He, you know, we lost the race by like 8 minutes, but the thing was like slow.
Melting, yeah.
It was like going 80 miles an hour max. And we need a bike to go 100, you know.
Yeah.
So we just like, every corner we're just like, faster, you know, because on the straights we couldn't go because it just got too hot, you know.
That's crazy. And you and Steve Hengeveld were sort of the dynamic duo through all your Baja wins, or most of them.
Yeah, we brought Steve along in the late 90s, like around 98. Yeah, right at the end of 98, we were looking for a partner for myself and stuff. And Steve came off a KX250. He was
he's a moto guy.
250 guy. He wasn't a moto guy, but
he grew up racing with me on mini bikes.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. He was. Yeah, he did all the amateur stuff and whatnot. So then he transferred to desert, and he was racing that, and he was looking for a ride. And I'm like, well, this guy's – because we always tried to look for somebody who's kind of riding Honda or somebody's riding a four-stroke. And
yeah,
you
they
know,
can
whatever.
Understand. Yeah.
They can kind of transfer. And so Steve – so we groomed him for a year or two on a B team. And then once he really started to come along, we were just like, okay, let's – we put us together, and then it was like the – you know, then party over.
Yeah.
You know. Hmm. So, yeah, Steve was, you know, incredible night rider. Like, I'd race during the day, and then we put him on at night, and he'd race
really
eight hours through the night. And
is that a really different skill set? What's
or
just some people are comfortable in it, and some people aren't?
Yeah, it's a different dynamic because our lights are really good. I mean, you could race really hard, but the cool thing about racing at night with good lights is that you don't have those outside distractions.
Oh, yeah, true.
You know, so your focus is here.
Yeah.
Whatever's going on just outside the lights, who cares, you know? And during the day, you're inputting all this stuff.
Right. But when you don't see anything out, you know, out of the peripherals, to me, I almost feel like I would want to see that mountaintop so I know I'm still heading in the general right direction. That wasn't an issue?
No.
Just sort of getting that tunnel vision
a little bit? Because we pre-run so much that we know the course like a motocross track. I mean, you could say, how do you memorize 300 miles of course?
Yeah.
We do.
Really?
Yeah. We break it up into sections. Go from this pit to this pit or this section. And I could go along and I could still tell you where rocks are down there. You know?
Did you always, when you did Baja so many times, did you always run the same segments? So, because you knew those? Or do you think you've raced all the different?
I've raced all the different segments. But like when Steve and I... When we got our dynamic together, it was like I usually started the race, and then he rode at night, you know, and so he was just really good at that, you know, and it became kind of like his image, you know.
Yeah.
And so we just stuck with that for a long time, a lot of seasons, and it just worked.
He was like Batman.
You know, there's
she came out at night. Yeah.
Yeah, there's different stresses. You know, there's stresses starting the race. You know, butterflies on the start line.
Yeah.
There's stresses at high noon when you can't see very good, you know. And then there's stresses at night or dusk when lights don't work, nothing works, and you're just, you know, got to get through there.
I would just be terrified of, you got this great field of vision right here, but, like, as you're hauling ass a cow just starts walking into your light.
I've
and
hit
you know
him.
What happens?
I've hit him.
Have you?
Yeah. Yeah. I've been very fortunate.
Steak dinner?
I don't know. I didn't stick around to find out.
I didn't wake her up. But the locals were sure happy.
Yeah.
What is it? I hear you rode with a bulletproof vest once or something like that.
There's a point in time where Baja was a little bit risky for sure. Well, it's always risky.
A point in time.
But yeah, we in 98 there was a kind of a rash of robberies in Mike Sky Ranch area. Mm. And so I was pre-running on Tuesday, going up a road, and there was other people pre-running and stuff. Not a lot, but there was some of the top guys down there, whatever. And I was going up a road, and the whole time you're down there, you're looking ahead, because there's a lot of blind corners and stuff. So you're trying to see a puff of dust or a car coming backwards, or cattle.
That's
or
sketchy
something.
Too.
Yeah. So you're freaking hauling ass, and you get comfortable down there, like. You're like, oh, if the truck's coming, I can just go over here or whatever. You know, you get a little bit
cocky.
Cocky. And so anyway, I was going up this road, and I thought I saw something up here where the road kind of goes. So I kind of slowed down, went around a corner, and there's this guy with a purple sock on his head, like with a rifle. Like, I'm like, whoa, like I stopped, you know. And then two other guys come out of the bushes, and they, you know, gun in the belt, you know, they have rifles, and they're just like yelling at me in Spanish. And
do you speak any Spanish?
Only little bits. Little,
yeah, okay. Little beer and bathroom and exactly. Tacos.
The important, exactly. Stuff.
Yeah, exactly. So anyway, they tell me get off the bike. They throw the bike over in the bushes, and they're like, walk up the road. I'm like, okay. So, you know, it's a little nerve-wracking when somebody's like got a gun pointed at you, and he shot a couple rounds in the air, and it's like, okay, this is... You know, so then I'm, you know, being the spiritual guy, I'm just praying, going, okay, this could be it, you know, whatever. Walking up the road, they tell me to go off the road in the bushes in case somebody came up the road, they wouldn't see us, right? So they start rifling through my fanny pack and
you're by yourself.
I'm by myself, and they're looking for money, basically. And so the guy tells me to pull my pants down. I'm like, okay, I'm dead, because if they want something else, I'm going to fight, right? So he saw I didn't have anything. So then one guy found a bunch of cash I had in my fanny pack, and then they just told me to go. So when you have a traumatic, event like that, you're kind of spooked for a while. Like, I remember, for like 6 months, mountain biking. I used to mountain bike every single day for training. I'd be like, there's a little noise in the bush. I'm like, like that. And so when I went back down to Mexico, I had gotten a flak vest to pre-run in and stuff. And so I was wearing it for like one or two trips after. And then finally, it was just a weird security
isolated thing. Incident could be too.
Dude, that's, I mean, you were held up at gunpoint though. That's gnarly.
Yeah, it was Wild West for sure.
Yeah.
It was Wild West Then, later that week, a guy tried to go by. They tried to hold up and block a car that was pre-running, and he just, tried to go
Mowed
through.
Him down.
He shot through. They shot through the window, and the bullet hit the steering wheel, went in the guy's leg. So they got him out of there, but he was with his mom pre-running. So then, at the riders' meeting, they said, oh, yeah, we got these guys. They're bad guys, whatever. It's not going to happen again. The mayor came out from Ensenada and said, blah, blah, blah. Well, a year later, some more problem happened again. Actually, an old retired fireman guy had a bunch of his fireman buddies on a ride going up there, and the same thing happened. Well, they ended up catching these guys, and he identified them in jail. So he knew, because one guy had really weird, crazy eyes. Mm. Like, where one eye was maybe fluttering over
little,
here.
A little cockeyed?
But he identified him, because I remember the guy too. And
was
said,
it, it was one of the guys that held
you
up?
Yeah. 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 So they were a group of brothers that lived on a ranch up there, and they kind of knew when guys were coming.
There's always opportunists out there.
Look at that. Fireman saving the day.
Yeah.
What are you talking about?
Yep.
Probably had a rad mustache too.
He probably did have a great mustache. That's wild, man. I'd have been done.
It was.
I actually,
I almost didn't race that week. I was nervous, but
I would bet I could have scared him off with the smell of shit in my pants.
my guess. Especially if it's downwind, the guy's like, you know what?
Hey,
you,
just go.
This
just
one, go. This one smells funny.
Hey, I had some really bitchin' titanium tire irons that some engineers in Japan gave me, and they were in that pack. And those guys, you know, they got them and just went like, tossed them. I was like, my tire irons. Who cares about the $500 they found?
Yeah, right. At that point, you're like, take the money. Leave me alone, please. Yeah.
It's like that. Remember, Krippa had that really cool axle wrench, and it was like a wrench from metalworking in Japan. So it had, like, it was a pointed end, so he could shove it in the axle, and he could put it on really quick and then run the axle on. It was like a 32.
Yeah, he used to do all our rear wheel changes with that thing.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah,
you know, we were like, "Here, use the impact." He's like, "No," you know,
with a sandwich in his hand.
Yes, of course.
So a fantastic sandwich.
Yeah, with pepper. Remember, he put peppers on them. They were really good with peppers on them.
He was a genius. Yeah. Well, I mean, at the kitchen. I was surprised you didn't go back. You probably knew right where that happened. I know where the spot is.
Yeah,
you didn't ever go back and hunt around in the bushes for those irons?
I did. Yeah. You know, future trips years later, I kind of looked around and.
What about booby traps?
So booby traps.
You ever deal with that over the years?
Yeah, I mean, sometimes the locals will build. They'll try to build a jump, or if it's in a sand wash, they might try to dig a hole or whatever. But you know, 90% of the time, if you see a crowd, you check up.
Suspect, yeah.
You know, I've raced through sections going, and you get to know it over the years. I go, okay, they're going to build something here. They're going to build something over here. There might be something here. And so you're racing along, and you see a big crowd, and you're like, okay, what's up? Oh, yeah, the dirt's different color, you know. And there's been times where I've gone around the crowd. Like, they built this jump or something, and I'd gone this way around them and kept going, you know. And they're just like, what? And I was like,
well, you see the videos once in a while where they get somebody. I saw them, I don't know where it was, there's a video clip of them getting a truck that came through hauling and hit something they'd built, and it just goes end over end.
Yeah, they'll like I said, they'll build a kicker or something, and it's like you can't do anything about it. But the rule of thumb is you see people, you slow down, you know? And if you
I'll remember that next time I go down. Yeah.
That doesn't work in a supercross stadium.
Yeah, exactly. No, when I was riding in South Africa, people didn't like bikes in a certain area, and they put wire across and caught me.
Oh, that's sketchy.
And I remember it was a big wake up call. Just never get too comfortable. Always be on alert.
Yeah.
So take us through your first Baja win. What year and what did that feel like? That'd have been something you'd been working at for a decade, right?
Yeah. So I raced, started Baja 1000 like 91, and then was able to do it every year up until, or 93 I didn't because I broke, but 97 was the first win. And so it took a few years to kind of put it all together and stuff. And I had two partners there, a guy named Greg Bringle, who's a former ATV racer from the Low Desert, Brawley area. And then Tim Staub, a San Diego kid. And unfortunately, he got injured back in like 01. He had a head injury. But those guys rode with me, and so I kind of carried the team and stuff. But so that was kind of like finally, you know, we've been working at this thing for several years, and we finally got it. And then it was just like, then I just didn't want to let go of it.
And that was the XR600 still?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That was XR600 in 97. So our first race on the XR650 took place in 99.
Okay.
And that other kid, Tim Staub, rode with me. And it was a crazy race that year in 99. We did two laps. It was like two 350-mile laps. And so the second lap, I'm catching cars at night. And it's so freaking dusty.
And sketchy.
Yeah. So it was a challenging one.
That first win, was it like perfect, or did you guys have challenges? Was it one of those things that everything came together, or
no? Everything came together good. I built the bike. Bruce put together the effort, and it was just like we put things in place, and it just kind of went. It kind of went like clockwork. I think, if I'm not mistaken. Mike Healy was racing on another team down at the time. He came down and had a kind of like a 2-year stint at doing some Baja stuff.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And,
I didn't either.
I remember one of the races around that time, I had a good race with him for a long time. It had rained the night before, and I'm like, oh, my gosh, I'm not good at mud, and he's been in Europe all this time, you know. And we went back and forth and back and forth, and then finally we got to some really long roads, and I took off. But yeah, Healy might have been in that race. I forget all the players at that point in time. But it was, as far as I know, it was a pretty smooth operation, and we didn't have a lot of hiccups. So
that's cool.
And then good. 9 years straight.
Yeah, 9 years straight. So, you know, then
That's pretty remarkable. Like when you think about it, there's so many things that can go wrong and can happen to do it like that. Yeah. Which one is the hardest?
Man.
Out of those 9 in a row. Because there's always an easier win or a one where you literally just pulled it out of the bag at the end.
I mean, in 2001, I hit a cow that we were talking about earlier. It was just going down a sand wash, kind of like the two track. I was just came out of a corner, like, you know, third to fourth, brah, and this thing just darted out. And I remember the silhouette of the head, and it was just like, bam, you know, just yard sale. I flipped over, landed flat on my back, and everything came to a stop. And it was kind of a cushioned soil, kind of a sand wash. And I'm just like, okay, I taste blood. I'm wet. I'm like, nothing hurts. I can wiggle my toes. That's awesome. So the blood was from the cow.
Ugh.
It hit like the lower triple clamp area and like dusted the front fender. Boom. And then I just endoed, and then the wet was my hydration system just burst.
Oh. So it was like an airbag, huh?
I didn't get a scratch on me. Perfectly preserved. I went back to the bike, picked up the bike. I'm like, okay, front fender's damaged, whatever. Bike's perfect. No coolant leaking, no nothing. Take off, and, you know, first corner comes up, oh, no front brake. So it bent the disc.
Oh.
So I rode the thing 20 or 30 miles to the next pit, you know. And the other thing, too, is we had helicopters at those times for radio communication. And so I told the helicopter radio ahead to the pit, tell them I need a wheel. So
did you tell them there was some ground beef back there?
Radio Black Angus, yeah. Tell them we have a cow down. Yeah.
But was the cow dead?
I don't know.
Did it get up and go run off?
Because I've seen a cow get hit by a car and it's still alive. So
and I've killed cows with the box van down there too.
Really?
Yeah. Like it's dark at night, and you know, and the road goes down, and you just turn up, and the lights. Oh, there's a cow, and it's just like boof. You know, cow goes flying, and fans through the radios to the fan.
Yeah.
And
jeez, seems like a lot of cow issues in Mexico. I know
there is definitely.
Malcolm Smith's son just not that long ago hit a cow at
night.
Oh,
yeah. Alexander hit one. Yeah.
That story is insane, too. He broke his femur, among other things.
Yeah.
And spent all night in some, like,
oh my gosh,
dingy little cell where they took him, waiting for a flight back to
get
to the
surgery.
States. All night long, no pain meds, with a broken femur. Like, no thank you.
Yeah. That's the risk you take going to remote places. You know, that could happen in the Mojave Desert or somewhere, too. It's just, you know, that's part of the thing that also makes us feel alive, going and adventuring or doing this type of stuff, you know. But getting back to like that, what was a difficult race to win was the one thing that could have been me. That could have been broken femur, could have been broken anything or dead or whatever. I was totally preserved.
That's crazy.
I went on and won the race.
The sand, your water pack.
I was going to say, if you land on that water pack, it's also a little cushion on the spine.
Yeah, it did. Exactly. Just
too bad they didn't have GoPro back then.
So
that would have been amazing footage.
So, and then probably one of my favorite, like, Baja 1000s that we won was in the year 2000, they called it the Baja 2000. And it was almost 1,700 miles down the peninsula, kind of like traversed back and forth more, used more roads. And we ran a four-man team, Steve Hengeville, myself, Craig Smith. He was another kid from the Low Desert, and Tim Staub. And so I rode 6 different stints, and it took us 32 hours to complete the race.
Jeez, why did they? Can they do that? They can just change the lengths, huh? I mean,
you just use different roads and different trails. You just lay it out, you know. And it was like 31:59 was like our time, And it's like we started one morning, and then like the next day afternoon, we finished in Cabo.
That's crazy.
Yeah, it was pretty cool.
So you do 9 straight, which I can't imagine the pressure to. After about 5-6, you're going, okay, now we're on a roll.
We have to win. Oh, it sucks.
Yeah.
How about everybody else that he's showing up down there?
Well, and we see, you know, like if you look at any champion that has a streak going, like Ryan Villopoto, when he was trying to win 3 in a row, it's like the pressure to not lose.
Yeah. Almost exceeds
the joy of actually winning anymore. And it's like, okay, I'm expected to win.
Yeah.
Did you get to that point where you're just like, you weren't enjoying it because there was so much pressure to keep winning?
No, I mean, I was enjoying it because I was still like felt physically good and primed and focused and not, you know, not afraid and stuff. And so it was, you know, we got to the 9th one was awesome. When I went for the 10th, that's when things got crazy because that was the introduction to, that was in 06. So that was the introduction to the new CRF 450X. So that whole year we developed the bike and we weren't, you know, at first when it came, we were kind of like, is it going to take place of the XR? Is it going to do it? That was a big step, you know, to go at a lightweight racing four stroke. It was based off like the 02 CRF 450 Honda's first, you know, so it had a couple seasons of motocross and stuff. And then they came out with that. And, you know, Ogilvy and Dre Dirks and Spud Walters did all the development on that X, which that X just, you know, we just built a new one. So it spanned like a long time. Really good bike. But anyway, that year we weren't really sure, is it going to take place of the XR? You know, it's not a big single four-stroke, you know, it's like more racy. And so we ended up doing a lot of development testing. Japan helped us and built a good ignition that we can run our big lights and everything. And also what I got tasked with, what Ogilvy said, hey, he had a lot of production development that year. And he said, hey, you have to build the pit program to facilitate this bike because we're going to race this bike. And so these huge crates of parts just kept coming to American Honda. And so I had to basically break all that stuff out and build, you know, pit spares and race spares for a 1,000-mile race. And, you know, I'm not only thinking for my bike, my team, I'm thinking for the B team. I'm thinking for the pit customer pit support. So I spent 3 months building all this whole system, and it was a lot of focus on that and not a lot of focus on myself riding and stuff. And then we actually switched up the teams a little bit. And so I rode with a couple of younger riders, Kendall Norman and Robbie Bell at the time.
Yep.
And they, and I was riding the last. So I was going to ride the night section, and so was Hingeville. So I was going to ride against my old partner. So I was okay.
And why did you do that? I'm like, why did you split it up that way?
It came down to it where I think Bruce was trying to kind of reorganize and structure the team to where the future and different things. And the younger guys were really fast on the new bike too.
Okay.
You know? So anyway, it just, you know, if I look in hindsight, I go, oh gosh, man, I should have rode with Henji and this other guy and stuff like that. But anyway, the teams got played out, and that's how, what we did. And the younger riders took, Robbie took the start, Kendall took this middle section of the peninsula, and I did the last 300 miles in the night. And Robbie ended up crashing, and then he got a flat, and he's way behind. Kendall got on the bike and tried to make up time, broke his arm, had to ride like 70 miles back out to the pavement. And I was still far south where I was staged. And so I couldn't drive that far back up to get the bike. And so Robbie, when he got to get back on the bike. And
he was beat up, right?
And he was smoked because he had, you know, he had raced all that time and he was hurt. But he got back on the bike. He brought the bike to me in a section he hadn't pre-run at night. So we were like, and so Hingy got on the bike, his bike down there like 2 hours before I did. We were still second overall.
Jeez.
It got spread out, you know. Mm-hmm. So we got Hingy off, and he went on and won the race, and then I brought the bike in second. And so that was the end of the streak.
Yeah.
You know?
How did you do against Steve in that night section? Did you make up any time on him?
He kicked my ass.
Did he?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's his jam, huh? Nighttime.
That's his jam. Yeah. And at that point in time, it was like, I'm not going to make up 2 hours on anything.
No.
So it's like, just be safe. Yeah. You know? Bring it in. And so it was kind of like mixed emotions at the end of that race because, yeah, I was bummed my win streak and I didn't get 10 in a row.
Because it's such a cool number when you go 10 in a row.
Yeah, I got 10 in a row. But it didn't make the stories better how it turned out. But anyway, but I was super stoked that all the effort and the responsibility that was put on my shoulders to build the effort and everything went really good.
Yeah.
And both 450Xs came across the finish line.
One and two.
There was no big problems. And so we succeeded as a team.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And that's where my joy came from in that.
That's cool.
And but then it was like so for me in my career, it's like I got to like 5 or so wins in the 1,000 and I was like, you know, there's really only one guy that has a record, and that's Rossler. Rossler had 10. Mm-hmm. And they weren't consecutive, but he had 10 Bahama 1,000s on a motorcycle. And so at one kind of point, Bruce goes, so what do you think? You want to keep racing? I'm like, yeah, I want to keep racing. Because I had some job opportunities at Honda, too, to, you know, go into development or whatever at that time. And so I said, no, I want to keep racing. And I go, let's go after Rossler's record, you know. So together, Bruce and I said, yeah, let's make it happen. So, you know, that was the goal.
At 5 wins, you were going after 10.
10.
That's a lot of work.
So it's a lot of work, but I was still kind of in my prime-ish, you know. And I was like 32. Because I think from like, in my arena, from like 28 to 32, man, that's
a sweet spot.
Yeah. I felt good. You had the experience, but you're still strong.
Yeah.
You know?
I hear you.
And then kind of, I had a bad crash, like an 02, a little bit after that, and kind of knocked the crap out of me. And then that's, you know, and Hingy had started being my partner. So he kind of carried the team at that point. And I was really, we were partners and we raced together and stuff, but Steve really did a good job the next several seasons of like, you know, because he was hungry.
Pulling his weight, yeah.
And I still wanted to do it, but I was a notch off, I believe. You know, and so anyway, that was, and so we went after it, and it took up until 2008 is when I finally got my final.
So you went 9, missed the 1, and then did you go 2 again, right?
Yeah. So we did 2 in a row, and in that time is when Bruce got sick, and I had taken over the team. So the first year I was a team owner, I still raced. And got that 11th, and then I was like,
"Yeah, I'm done."
I was like, "Okay, enough risks and stuff." Yeah. And so
that's amazing. Well, hey, we're gonna take a quick break, TLD beer break here. If you're at home drinking a beer, thank TLD for it, and we're gonna be right back with more Johnny Campbell. Stay tuned. Welcome back. That was the Troily Designs beer break. Be sure to check out Troily Designs for all the new gear. If you've seen Cole Seeley at the races or the race team guys, they're usually representing all the new lines. There's some crazy cool new stuff coming out, so check those out. New colorways, SE4 helmet still, and all the GP and SE gear. Also want to give you guys a little heads up. If you have been waiting for Whiskey Throttle Show merchandise, like this one right here, this shirt, it's available. WhiskeyThrottleMerch.com. You can go there and buy T-shirts. We've got ladies' tanks. We've got hats coming here this week. Lots of cool new designs, new colors, stuff coming. So check that out and get over there and support the fastest show on the planet. We appreciate it. And we're back here with Johnny Campbell, El Campeón. That's what they call you down there, huh?
Some do.
Some do. That's what happens when you win that race 11 times. I wanted to circle back. You know, you mentioned hitting a cow and all this, but you never talked about getting hurt. Have you ever had any big injuries during your career?
Yeah, I've had quite a few, but fortunately in Baja, I was pretty preserved. Like I never had any bad Baja injuries.
Mm. Yeah,
yeah, there we go. Got a nice big piece of wood to knock on, right?
Yeah, most of my injuries came from racing stateside, you know, and probably, you know, I broke my back out testing here in Barstow, and you know, some races out of Pahrump, Nevada, crashed, got knocked out and flown out, and spent the night in UMC in Vegas. And, you know, I had some pretty damaging ones where I've, you know, fractured vertebrae and got three different collarbones, you know, broken ribs and multiple ankles, multiple wrists, the kind of the same.
Any internal injuries?
Not that I'm aware of.
You know? Not that I'm aware of.
I think
of.
You'd be aware, yeah. Probably.
I was spitting blood the one day, but I don't know if that had anything to do with it.
Yeah, I am a little bit slower speaking now, so I don't know if that's from five concussions or it's just...
Five's not too bad.
Have you had
for
some
what
big
you
ones?
Did as a profession?
Yeah, I mean, I've been knocked out about five times, and you know, there's probably other ones too, but yeah, I've had some pretty big run-ins at high speed, you know, really, really fortunate. And
that's something about, you know, supercross and motocross guys are hurt left and right all the time, but it's a lot of ligaments and bones and bruises and this and that. The scary thing about, especially Baja, is there's when you go down, sometimes you're dying. I mean, we've lost Caselli and Hamill and some, like, legends, you know. Is that rocky? Was that something that you had to work to get past, or are you just like, well, occupational hazard?
You know, I was down there when Hamill passed away, and that all went down and stuff, and it was a really scary moment, and definitely, like, my wife and I had to, like, come to grips with, you know, that was reality right in our faces, a 25-year-old kid, you know, and I had to, you know, pray about it and stuff. And I think that, you know, I just feel like if you're not going after your passion or your dream and the stuff like we've done, then you're really not living. You're not living the life that God wants you to. Because part of living is the faith element that you have to make that step, you know, and you have to go. And so... you can't just live in a box, you know, and or else your life really is that really living, you know?
Yeah.
So go do what you want to do, dream about it, be as safe as you can, but be skilled and know, be aware of your surroundings, be aware of the risks, and then you can make your decisions whether you're going to do that activity or not,
right?
You know, and so I decided I was going to race motorcycles, and that's all I wanted to do when I was a kid. And so I'm fortunate to get through my whole professional career, and now I enjoy riding motorcycles. And, you know, I wish I still had that body, but...
Yeah, well, don't we all? you know, something Greg Albertine, we got to get him on here. I don't know why, but he would always say to me, because there was a couple of times, you know, like when Jimmy Button got hurt or Ernesto Fonseca, there's just times where you go, man, what am I doing? I don't know if you ever had those where you kind of question it and you wrestle with it a little bit. And he says, look, God gave you a spirit of courage, not fear. So, you know, like you just said, think about it, process it, whatever you got to do, and then, like, do what it is you want to do, like you just said. Yeah. And I mean, but that doesn't mean that makes it easy, especially if you know those guys. Danny was like, and Kurt, I mean, man, just like, everybody loved him.
Yeah, and they were phenomenal people. Yeah. And they were phenomenal champions, and their skill was unbelievable on the bike. I mean, for Danny, I don't know anybody ever come along that was as impressive on a bike as he was. Mm-hmm. It was, you know, incredible talent and, you know, and just a genuine human being, you know, and Kurt was the same way, you know, and it's just like, it's risky. What we do is risky.
Yeah, yeah.
And you just have to either accept that and go for that adventure or don't, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, that's it. It's just, gosh, I hate seeing guys like that. Not like suck to see anybody who's gone, but
yeah,
man, those guys are missed for sure.
Yeah,
absolutely.
So of all of the racing you've done, the Baja titles, the most important, are those the most valued to you?
Yeah, the Baja titles were the most valued. That's what I focused my goal on, you know, early on was like, there's all sorts of different types of off-road racing and stuff, but that was the one that was closest to my heart and my passion and have a lifestyle of going down to Mexico and pre-running and eating tacos and talking to the local people and, you know, and that was the most natural for me, you know, even though I can't speak Spanish still.
Yeah. But correct me if I'm wrong, wouldn't you say Honda, Kawi, everyone, that was also their main focus was to win the Baja?
Yeah.
If there was one sort of event everyone wanted to go
to win. In the off-road world.
Yeah. You say the Baja 1000 anywhere in the world, they understand. You go, I race off-road. Oh, what's that? You know, I race the Baja 1000. Oh, yeah, I know what that is. You know,
Dakar.
Or they've heard about it.
Yep.
Or like Dakar's the same way,
yep.
You know.
What about the other disciplines? Did you do any GNCC racing? What about enduro? Or there's so many different disciplines, and like I'm buddies with Dusty Abbott, but for a long time I didn't know what he even raced. I'm like, is it hare scrambles, hare and hound? What's the difference? What's you know? There's a lot of little different niches,
and I think that's what's really fun about the off-road side of it is because it's a really individual enthusiast, a passion-driven thing. It's not because somebody wants to become a pro or make money doing it, you know, like we all had, you know, some focus of that at some point in our career, but it's, these people just enjoy riding the motorcycle, you know, and they enjoy the challenges of riding a hare scramble through the mud or a GNCC or a desert race and a hare and hound and, you know, and having a fulfillment of that freedom and stuff. And that's what a motorcycling is all about, you know? And
that's a very pure thing too. That's something I do love about off-road is motocross has seen kind of struggles in attendance numbers. But if you go look at a GNCC race or even Works, I think they're still doing well. They're packed.
Yeah.
GNCCs have so many people and guys are going, well, I could go to a track like you said and ride 2 10-minute motos and waste my whole day. Mm. Or I can go ride 3 hours, you know.
Yeah.
In 3 hours.
In 3 hours and go home.
Yeah, so. And you can see that racing part of it is a GNCC, you know, they're getting numbers over 2,000 entries at some events.
Crazy.
The NGPC, which is the Big Six series, it's now a national series. They're getting, you know, anywhere from 1,300. And even at Atlanta, we had like 2,500 entries, you know. So that's
lovely to see.
It's great to see. You know, it's great to see our but it took a dive for a while, you know.
Sure.
But now those races are really going strong, and it's fun to see. So I grew up Grand Prix racing. So that was kind of like a form of motocross, but a form of crossover and off-road, you know. So I really enjoyed that. And then when District 37 started doing more Grand Prix, and then now it's evolved to a national series, you know, that's kind of like close to my heart because that's what I grew up doing.
Yeah.
So I did that. I went and I've done 2 GNCCs, actually 3 if you include like a really poor effort at a super senior class last year. back when I was in my heyday, I went back to Scott Summers Ranch in Kentucky and stayed there for a week and, you know, rode his trails and tried to figure it out. And I was just a complete fish out of water. And
I was going to say, like, did he ever come out here and do any of your stuff?
Yeah. Before I knew him and before I raced for Honda, Scott came down and he raced Baja. He tried it a couple times and it's equally as tough for him to do that as it is for me to do GNCC, you know, and it's just the discipline. The real, the real cool thing is like when you see guys like, Ty Davis or Destry or Rossler, Kurt Caselli. Those guys are really multifaceted.
Yeah.
You know? And one guy I'd like to shout out is like Danny Laporte. Laporte was really, like if you hear him talk, he goes, I saw on a Sunday, I wanted to do all those things. He goes, yep. He was world champion. He was motocrosser. He won Baja 1000. He gold medalist ISD. He almost won the Dakar Rally. You know, he did a bunch of those things. You know, my skill set was mostly Grand Prix, desert, Baja. Mm-hmm. You know, I did some rally, but not a lot. I probably could have been better at that if I focused on it. But, you know, me riding enduros is super fun and killer, and I love it. But I was never very fast at it.
Okay.
You know? And I wasn't very skilled at it. So me riding motocross, same thing. It's like I used to race REM at Carlsbad a bunch and stuff like that. I did Golden State 1 year, like when I was a novice, and you know, I experimented in it, but it wasn't my skill set, you know, and it wasn't my passion. So
it's so interesting that it is that specialized though, right?
Yeah.
But you go back in those, like you're probably talking about at Summer's place in Kentucky, it's tight woods and roots, and he's just
a lot of mud holes.
Oh, man.
Water crossings.
And you can really appreciate the talent and the skill and the technicality if you watch those guys go through the woods, you know, guys like Caleb Russell, who's dominant back there.
He you watch me just like flow through there, and you're like, I could do that. I've tried it. I'm shoulders hitting the trees, and I'm like,
it's beautiful to watch because it's something that I could never achieve, you know. Mm. And you know, had I grown up and doing it, okay, maybe, but I appreciate that. I appreciate the guys in motocross and road race and all the disciplines that can, you know, it's phenomenal to watch.
Did you ever feel like Larry switched over? Larry Russell switched over to trucks. Were you ever offered that, or did you ever think about driving a truck down there?
Yeah, I've actually dabbled in that, and I don't know if we were going to get to that a little bit, but I've raced like Cameron Steele's trophy truck in Barstow. The last two Baja 1000s, I've raced the Honda Ridgeline. It's a Class 7 truck. It's a smaller truck. It's kind of like I guess for lack of better terms, mini trophy truck, but it's kind of an unlimited mini truck class. A guy named Jeff Proctor owns that team, and it's backed by American Honda and HPD, which Honda Performance Development does the engine, you know. And so Jeff's been really gracious to me to let me drive a stint the last 2 years, and it's really cool. I really dig it.
Yeah.
So fun. Because it's just kind of like you could get those juices flowing again, like you're racing. Even though, you know, but then you're like, okay, at least I got a cage and stuff and, you know, like
that's
that.
But with age comes a cage.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's really fun. But as far as the transition, for me, I've always been very responsible and I've had a family to provide for and stuff. And so the transition to go from the best, say the top of your field in Baja and then go get a truck, it's like there's no paycheck. There's no money. All the guys that are racing trophy trucks, most of them are very well-to-do guys, and it's a big hobby sport for them, and it's phenomenal to watch, and the adrenaline is crazy. You know, and there's a couple really, really professional guys like Rob McCachran, who's a racer, you know. Mm-hmm. He wasn't independently wealthy that races. There's like Cameron Steele. He builds all the sponsorship and media stuff and races, you know. So, they don't have a big wealth behind them. So it's really a niche to be able to do, you know. It's not like there's factories.
You got to own a construction company.
Well, we've seen a bunch of even motocross guys that try to go that route. And they're great drivers. If they had money behind them and wanted to stick it out, they probably could be winning races and competing for titles, but they all go, I'm not spending my money to go do this, you know, and that's what it comes down to.
Yeah, you've raced for umpteen years getting paid to do it, and then you go, I don't have the money to do that.
Yeah. The guys that are still doing it have massive money.
Yeah.
Metal militia money.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Yeah, that's a lot of fun. Those trucks are those trophy trucks.
Yeah, it's beautiful. I love it.
They're pretty gnarly. When you see them going through the desert now, the suspension technology has made those things just, I mean, they just watch them floating across the desert. It's pretty insane.
It's
to see it in person up close.
How have you done in that the class you're doing then? Have you guys?
The last two, we've gotten second. We've had some, you know, and it's always in Baja, in that, in the four wheels, always kind of like bikes used to be. It's like,
Stuff breaks.
And you get stuck.
You hit a rock, and
you get stuck in silt. That's kind of like the scary part for me. Is like I'm driving this thing. I do not want to get stuck. You know, and there's so many areas. By the time that class goes through, 40 trophy trucks have gone through, and it's deep silt. You know, so you got to be.
So if you get stuck, the fear is getting hit then by somebody.
Getting hit or just getting out. Just all the physical work.
Being stuck.
Getting the thing out.
Yeah, because you got to dig your way. And no one's going to stop and help you, right? They're not that friendly, are they?
They do sometimes. But you know what's crazy about Mexico is, like, even this last year's 1,000, we were way behind. I got in the truck, and I was driving the last section, and we were down on power, and I came up this hill, and I go, I got to be in it. And I was in it, and I bounced, and I rolled the thing over, and it was just like a laughing. It wasn't, you know, 25, 30 mile an hour. Boom, boom. Rolled over, landed, and I'm like, we're in the middle of nowhere. How are we going to get over, you know? We can't push it over. And, well, in Mexico, all of a sudden you hear a whistle, and you're, like, looking around. Here comes a local.
No way.
And their family, you know, they were watching the race down there and didn't see us come around. So that's the beauty of racing in Mexico. You know, the people down there that they come out, and, yeah, we could get it. You know, they got an old rusty chain or whatever. They pull you over.
Pull you around a cactus. Yeah,
it's beautiful.
That's awesome. So how did you do in the GNCCs that you did?
Not so good. You know, the first one I went back with Scott, we both raced XR600s because we did like a magazine thing. Uh-huh. And XR600 in wood, you got to be Scott Summers to like, you know, to wrestle that thing. I was a fish out of water. Ohio, clay, a deep rut, leading axle forks. You know, it was one of the toughest things that I've ever done. It was ride that first GNCC back then, and it was really difficult just because of the mud. Uh-huh. And then you get a rut, and there's trees, so you can't like get out. And yeah, I was thrashed.
I'm so happy to hear you say that. I did one. And I just said finish. I just gotta finish, and I did.
Yeah.
But man, physically, mentally, emotionally, just destroyed at the end of that thing.
Big respect to those guys.
Huge,
for sure.
Huge respect. And you know, Caleb Russell, talking about a guy who can transition. He's come out and done some nationals, and he's fast.
Yeah. He was impressive in Moto Hump.
I would love to see what he does in the desert. I wonder if he could translate into that, or
has
he ever done anything?
Like,
maybe you know. I don't know.
No, he actually came out and was racing the Grand Prix this last year because they didn't conflict with the GNCCs, and he struggled a little bit. Okay. He was always a competitor, but he wasn't dominant.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
like we're used to seeing him. Yeah. And so it was just kind of like getting used to like, oh, we're using fourth, fifth.
Yeah.
You know, so it's
speed. Yeah, just different mindset. And the speed differential as well. It's pretty crazy.
So when was your moment that you decided, okay, I'm probably done? It was after that, you kind of mentioned after that 11th win. But was there like, did you sit down, you and Faye, and go, okay, it's probably it? Or, I mean,
We'd been kind of feeling it, and then, you know, there's a couple rally racers around my era that had died and stuff, and then I was just kind of going, you know, I've had a couple bad ones, and it's just like, you know it, and I didn't want to be the guy that just tried to hold on to it, and then I got injured, and I ruined this
amazing career.
This amazing career. Just like,
it's always that struggle, and I think any racer's head is, when is the right time? Because people will go, oh, you still got it, man. You should stick it out a little while.
Yeah, you got fans, and they want to support you. You know, oh, you should still race. Because even when I took the team on, I had even some of my volunteers go, oh, you should still race. We'll get this part of it for you. I'm like, you don't really understand how OCD I am about this organization and all this stuff. And so if I'm on the bike, I'm thinking of all that stuff
anyway,
and I'm not focused this way. So I said, you know what? It's better that I start transitioning and give those younger riders the knowledge that was given to me.
Yeah.
So, well, as much as he had that sit down, yeah, I'm not going to race, but we'll get a truck.
Well, the next step. Here once we go. A racer, always a racer. Yeah. Right? Yeah. I just remember for me, the fear that just I started really paying attention to my fear level.
Yeah.
Like I used to start, never bug. I was just always focused on I got to get the whole shot. Yeah. What's my best way to get the whole shot? And then 03, my last season. Man, there's 20 of us going into this turn. You know,
you're like, why am I thinking like this all of a sudden?
I just could tell my thoughts had changed.
That's the key.
The frontal cortex had fully developed.
Yeah, and I exactly.
was like, this is crazy.
but that is the right moment.
Yeah.
I mean, I agree with that. I think you've got to have that moment. I remember my dad said to me, the minute you have any fear of what your job or your occupation is, you need to walk away. The sport's too risky to be not there mentally 100%.
That's it, exactly.
What about, we just touched on this earlier, and you said you don't know too much about this electric bike that Honda's got out. And I know you work at Honda, and if you don't know much about it, that means they are very tight-lipped about it. But you mentioned you think the switch to electric, no pun intended, could be sooner than later.
Yeah, I just think with the way things are going and the kind of the energy level toward it is like, you know, things, you know, there is some genuine, excitement about it, kind of, you know. I think it's more just like energy, like, you know, Honda released some image and stuff like that, and then apparently they raced it, and then, you know, you have some of these other guys and stuff doing some stuff. And so it's going to happen, you know, I think eventually, but it's like, and also like we've talked about, like the fear for me is like, it doesn't make sense on a, ecological level.
Yeah.
Because where are all these batteries going to go?
Yeah.
You know, where are they, you know, I don't get it.
You got to charge them somehow too.
So I want BRAP. I want to be tuning those valves and trying to get that little bit of horsepower, and you know, that's where it's at.
Yeah, I wonder if it could be just another little niche, like electric racing is. Maybe it's there's an indoor series, because like I see that being a potential for it. Yeah. You could do it in like little warehouses, you know, where there's no emissions issues, you could build little tracks in there, like arena cross ish type stuff, and
yeah.
And now you're riding dirt bikes all winter, not, you know what I mean, back in some place in Iowa or whatever.
Yeah, and also think it there's the chance of opening up some areas too.
Yeah,
that's the thing, or not losing riding spots that we have already.
Well, no neighbors complain if you ride it in your yard. if you've got a big property.
Private owners, where you've got maybe a few acres, you could make something fun if you didn't have the noise.
Yeah, those are the benefits, but.
I'm see the pros and cons. Yeah, you're an old school racer, which I know for a lot of those people, including myself, it is hard to almost wrap your brain around the sport potentially looking a lot different in say 10 years from now.
And I just the thing that I one of the things I love about motorcycles is it taps into all your senses, right? Like so, the visual look of it, the sound of it, vibration, the smell, the vibe, all of it.
Yeah,
and you lose so many. You lose the smell. You lose the sound. You know, you lose the vibration. Like you said, it's down to just
all of a sudden you feel like you're like I never ever thought I would say I miss my bike vibrating. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think if they could, and we mentioned this earlier, if you could pipe in sound to it, and I know that sounds ridiculous, but like I think you're going to be on a phone app.
This will be a starter.
Two stroke today. CR80. Yeah, put that in. No. CR250. Yeah. Okay.
Cruiser noise.
Yeah.
The only tuning you do, you tune your rheostat. You just got to see, how's my rheostat?
So weird. So that transition and then into team manager, going back to this, I didn't mean to go off on that electric rabbit hole, but
that's all right.
How was that transition? Like the first year you're not racing Baja, you're managing. Was that kind of tough?
Yeah. Yeah. The whole manager part and dealing with personalities and young egos and stuff like that. It's a tough one. You know, it's like, dealing with racers and young racers, and they're trying to find their way, and you know, they got to feel like they're puffed up and everything. And, you gotta kind of feed each individual on how what makes them go, right?
Yeah. And what makes them tick.
You know, and then dealing with like a budget. Oh God, you know, it's like because now we're not.
That's one thing we all hate to discuss is that budget.
How's your Excel spreadsheet skills?
Horrible.
So are mine.
I think I'm still using a yellow sheet of paper.
Yeah.
I'm like, kind of like Bones.
Yeah.
You know, we're still paper. Yeah. That's why we get along so well.
Yeah.
So, that is a nice transition though. Guys that I think decide it's time to quit racing, they're like, okay, now what? Now, you know, you're not in the industry, you're not anything. That's a really scary place to be. So as hard as it might have been, you think this is a nice step down?
Yeah, it's been, like I mentioned before, it's been a phenomenal ride. Like, you know, now I've done JCR for 10 years and held it together. Like, I'm not a rich guy, you know? It's like, I got a race team that I've had a professional race team intact for 10 years. And a lot of times it's like a guy that has a lot of wealth, you know, that's able to, you know, facilitate. I've been just having to like, hey, Faye, don't buy any socks. You know, but we've been able to do it. And I looked at it like, okay, I'm not going to be getting a lot of those adrenaline challenges anymore from racing. You know, okay, God, I'm going to take this step of faith and you help build me as a leader, you know, in this aspect to, you know, take care of these guys and the team and the mechanics and do all the logistics and stuff. And so that's been my challenge. It's not my favorite, you know. My favorite was when I was 28 and I could just feel no fear, you know. Yeah. And I loved that. I love going down pre-run and I love, you know, finding a line. I love just, you know, racing and not being scared. But and that was the pinnacle of like that good feeling. And now as a business guy, you got to like kind of find that somewhere else. So
Do you find some joy though in watching the younger guys that you've helped along win?
Definitely the succession is awesome because I see like I'm working right now with Trevor Stewart. I'm working with Ricky Brayback, two young guys. Ricky's on a complete different level than Trevor. You know, Trevor's racing Grand Prix and that type of stuff. And Ricky's on this world level of Dakar Rally, you know, in which our goal is to win that thing someday. And
well, he was in good place.
Yeah, so we were really
devastated.
Devastated, and we're stinking close, you know. Yeah. So we can't quit now.
But I was going to say, to me, I think that would drive me for another year to go back there, like to be so motivated to go, we're going to get this.
Yeah. It's that close, you know. So I got to keep working with him. But seeing those guys succeed and now seeing, like, when we build an effort, like we just won the Mint 400 and we won the Sonora Rally right after that. And just having those, me being at the lead role in those efforts makes me feel good.
And for sure.
You know, I'm getting some of that winning feeling back, you know.
What trajectory is Brayback on? Is he focused on rally or like kind of what other little, what's going to be his niche? What's his Baja? Or is it Baja?
So it was Baja, okay. You know, Ricky's an interesting kid. He, you know, he was really a really heavy set kid. Like he was big, like a few years ago, like 12, 13. He was like almost 300 pounds. And then he completely transitioned himself, like a lot of discipline, trimmed down, and then he started winning. And then once he got connected with HRC, and then they kind of put me in charge of, you know, taking care of him and stuff. And so since then, his plan is win Dakar. I mean, that's the goal.
Okay.
You know, he was doing Baja with another team and stuff, and that's kind of, he still wants to do some of those races, but the main focus is Dakar. You know, we win that, and, you know, doesn't matter. You know, it's just like,
that'd be massive.
That's what we're trying to do.
That's what's interesting in off-road. It's like, and we don't have that where you guys pick one event and that's your Super Bowl. And he may do some other events dotted throughout the year, but that's the main focus.
That's it.
And you were the same way with Baja.
Yeah.
And you luckily had a lot of success, but that could be frustrating really quickly, right? Like if something happens next year, you know.
Yeah. So many things can happen in a rally too. I mean, there's so many technicalities of, there's so many rules and there's time schedules and there's a navigation and this electronic device that can fail and all, you know, yeah. just, you can get lost and there's so many variables. Oh, yeah. It's a super challenge. And that's kind of like that's my goal. You know, I want to win that and I want Honda to win it. And Ricky for me is the closest thing I can, you know, hang my hat on to making that happen, you know.
Yeah. Do you find you're able to help him with quite a bit of stuff? I mean, your rally experience was a little limited. You still were pretty dang competitive in it.
Yeah. I didn't do a lot of rally racing, like you said, but I also, like Jimmy Lewis is one of my good riding partners and friends and stuff Jimmy helped me become a better rider, and we used to train rally stuff together. And so he's really technical. And so what I did, since I don't have as much time to go out and help Ricky train like on a physical day to day and stuff with the rally stuff, I've had him hire Jimmy to help train him. And that was one of the key things from last year of all the other years is why he did so good this year in Dakar, is because he solely focused on that, and Jimmy had him doing drills throughout the season. You know,
interesting. That's cool. What happened at Dakar this year?
So multiple things happened, but this year, you know, they had a motor issue. I'm not at liberty to say what happened, but there was a motor issue and it failed.
Because he was leading with a day to go?
We had three stages to go.
Okay.
So there was three stages, but the last stage is always kind of like a little bit of a fluff stage. It's shorter and they try to make it so like everybody...
Grand finish.
Everybody finishes the same, even though things can change. And it did for like Paulo Quintanilla, who crashed.
I remember.
Because him and Price were neck and neck time-wise. And that's right where Ricky would have been. You know, had everything stay together, Ricky would have been, it would have been a three-way on the last day, which is really kind of unheard
rare,
of.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, you mentioned you do get some enjoyment working with young, talented kids, but you have one yourself. Preston?
Yeah.
Are you involved with him and the coaching, and where do you see him going?
Yeah, so Preston's 19 now, graduated last year. You know, he point blank told Faye and I, I'm not going to school. She said, okay, you got to work, you know. And so he went to work for my friend Hide Hanawa and Ryan Dudak at HRA, which is Honda R&D. So he's kind of like the intern there.
Oh, nice.
That's not Hide from Suzuki, is it? The same one? Okay.
No.
Okay.
So Hide kind of like wanted to start bringing him in and stuff. He grew up in a box van, so he knows about racers, he knows about egos, he knows about mechanics, and he's a really good mechanic too.
Really?
Yeah. So he's actually building his own 250 motors, you know, four strokes.
That's
so
cool.
So he can, but he's doing darn good, you know. He had a bad get off at Adelanto 2 years ago, broke his femur. Took him a year to come back. Then he had a big sinus issue, which he had to get surgery in his sinuses and stuff. And now he's kind of, you know, starting to step up and come of age. And he's riding the 250 Pro Class and Grand Prix and Hare and Hound Desert Racing and stuff. And so right now he's second in points in 250 Pro for Hare and Hound.
What's he want to do? Like, what's his focus?
As a kid, he wants to be a professional racer, right? Yeah. But he also is growing up around me, which, you know, it's like I wasn't always just a racer. I always had some sort of position and job. And so I thank God that the work ethic is in him, you know, that he knows that. He kind of gets that a racer's career is a short span and there's got to be something. So he's inside at Honda R&D. And, you know, he's been back to Ohio to the big facility and doing stuff. He's out on the test right now, and he's doing a really good job, you know, racing on the weekends and training when he can. And
does he have a like a a discipline that he likes? Is he like the desert stuff? Does he want to do Baja? Yeah.
No, he doesn't really want to mess with the desert. He's just doing Hare and Hounds just because my team's going there and it's easy for him.
Okay.
But he generally does like a tough off-road race. Like if it's technical and rocky and there's something off-roady where it's a step aside from motocross, because he's a decent motocrosser too. But he knows that he's not, because he started racing some of like the Mammoth qualifiers, and he was on the same track as some of the guys that are winning the lights right now, like Faulkner and that stuff at Mammoth, you know, a few years back. But he was never like in that domain. And so he tried to do some motocross and stuff, and we just saw how challenging it was. And he's just like, I don't want to do this, you know? And so he had a lot of friends in the district Grand Prix and desert racing. And so he has a good group of friends there and goes racing and rides every chance he gets. And
yeah, cool.
So
sounds a lot like his dad. Work hard, play hard.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's awesome. And do you get to work with him a whole lot?
Yeah. So, you know, occasionally, like if I'm called out on a test, I'll, you know, he's there in some capacity. I don't know. Sometimes, you know, and it's stuff that he knows stuff that he can't tell me, you know.
That because, is funny. Huh? You would love to know that, yeah. You know.
Yeah. You know, he's a super quiet kid. He doesn't say, you know, he's in a perfect role for his demeanor. So
yeah. How good. Yeah. What's the goals for your team? Let's say between now and the next 5 years.
You know, we've been in, you know, I'll have to back up a little bit on that because I've been transitioned a few places. Like JCR did Baja from 08 to 13. 13 was the year that Caselli passed away and things were changing in Mexico. And
how so?
It changing is that the organization changed owners. Okay. Roger Norman bought the thing from Selfish. And so there was a little changing of the guard there. And there was a little growth period. I came in, or at that point in time, there was some insurance problems too for me to be able to get the required insurance to actually race those races, to be to protect Honda, protect all our sponsors and whatever. And so I backed away from it, and Honda says, he goes, we want to get back in GNCC. Okay, well let me look at that. So. And the end of 13, I stopped doing Mexico because I figured, you know, I've been there for, 20 years, and we've won and done everything we can that I felt like I've accomplished everything I could there, even though I loved it and the lifestyle and everything. I said, but, you know, there's people on the East Coast that I want to meet. I want to see this type of racing. I want to, you know, kind of jog my education on customers and bike setup and different things. And so, at that point in time, the RX line of bikes, the 450 RX, the 250 RX were in development, or they wanted to start developing them. So I went back to GNCC and we started our effort back there. So I stayed back there for 5 years. And, so this last year I decided, I don't want to travel back there. I want to focus, and Honda has a lot of product that needs attention out on the West Coast. A lot of the JCR fans and customers and stuff on the West Coast were in need of a little JCR.
Yeah.
And so I made a strategic move with Honda's blessing to come back to the West Coast and start focusing on the NGPC, which is a newly named Big Six series. So that became an AMA National Series. And then Ricky wanted to start doing the Hare and Hounds again. And so I said, you know, I'll focus on these two national series. I'll come back. I can handle that portion. And I can also, you know, and we have a good chance to dominate at those. And then the other thing was, you know, the rally development testing and the rally travel that I do with the HRC team takes quite a bit. And so I was traveling to the East Coast. And then I'd travel to a rally or I'd have to set up this big test. And so I was gone a lot.
Right.
And so I wanted to reduce that for my family's sake, reduce the travel. And then, so now I focus on, you know, the race team and then the rally side of things with HRC. And then I also get pulled into some production testing occasionally.
Were you living back east during the GNCC stuff or just popping in for races and back out?
Just popping in for races, basically. I'd go back there for short stints. But what I ended up doing, my mechanic here, Eric, he was happy to go back there. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he kind of lost his house and, you know, some stuff here. So he's just like, oh, I don't know, I'll go, you know. Yeah. So he fits perfect back in North Carolina. And so we ended up like renting a house back there and we operated everything out of there and he would take care of all the day-to-day stuff for the team there. And then I would do stuff from the West Coast and then fly in and out.
Okay.
And, cause I've never wanted to transplant back there. You know, I've checked out a lot of areas now and I was kind of like,
it's a big move.
It's a big move. The weather here is excellent.
Yeah. Well, especially if you're a off-roader, surfer.
Yeah.
It's probably the best spot to be.
And American Honda's here, you know.
Yeah.
And for me to facilitate the rally testing and that stuff for them, I need to be here. I need to have an outfit here. So
it's like having the test tracks out here. Like the manufacturers need the test tracks here.
Yeah. So if everybody's going to be in California and the industry's here, then I need to be here.
Yeah.
You know. And so we made a move back from GNCC to here. Eric actually stayed out there and went to work for Phoenix Racing, who now facilitates the Honda effort.
Yes.
And so, okay. So Honda tapped them to do GNCC.
Yeah.
You guys are pulling back.
They have a supercross team, off-road team. They're based out of North Carolina, right?
Yeah, Salisbury. Yeah. So about halfway through the year last year, you know, Dave, the owner, he started kind of poking around some of the GNCCs and say, hey, we want to come here with ATV and stuff. And I was kind of like, well, I wouldn't mind going back home. Mm. And so Eric, you know, so we kind of worked things out and then Eric went to work for him because he wanted to stay back there. And so they're underway and Dave's a good supporter and he has a good team going and stuff. And so, you know, so I'm really happy that I was able to hand that off in good hands. And then I was able to come back and start, you know, building back our empire out here.
Cool. Are you excited to be back kind of into the West Coast and this kind of racing you're more familiar with?
Absolutely. You know, I feel like a lot more at home and I'm available for my family more. I'm available, you know, for these riders here, you know, and especially Ricky, because he's such a key role in the global Honda, you know, thing that I needed to be here so that I can, you know, be here for him and be a mentor, you know.
Yeah. That's interesting. So you have two kids?
Yeah. Yeah. Preston's 19. He's my son. And my daughter's Paris. She's 17. She has a pretty cool story, too. And when I went and did Paris to Dakar in 01, you know, my wife came over with me. And then I went and raced. And she went home. And then I got home. And she goes, I'm pregnant. And so that was Paris.
Ah. One night in Paris.
Yeah, one night with some,
and Frank
might have been more than one night, but who knows? Yeah. We're not counting.
But Franco Cherby says, oh, it's the vino, it's the vino. You know, he says the wine. So
that's cool.
So yeah, she's amazing. I always tell her that. But she's, you know,
does she like to hear that story or is that like icky?
Dad, drop it.
I think she's kind of got used to it by now. Yeah. But she's actually in New York this week. She has a virtual enterprise program at her high school in Murrieta, which is a phenomenal program.
Vista Murrieta?
No, it's Murrieta Valley.
Okay.
So, but they have this class where they actually build mock corporations. And everybody,
yes,
yeah, and the kids interview for positions. They have a CEO, and she's in HR. And
that's blah, blah, blah. So funny. I just went through this. My son's going to that high school next year, and that was one of the things that we were talking about. I'm like, you know what? This is a program that is,
it's real,
brilliant. Like
it's brilliant. I'm like, Paris, run my business.
Yeah,
you know more than I know. You know,
wow,
it's a phenomenal real life class, real life
good
skills.
To know. I'm sending my kid through that one.
That's great.
It's good.
I'm a fan.
You can use in life.
I'm a fan.
Yeah.
So she wants to go into business. I mean, that's
well, she actually has changed what she wants to do. She's good at it. She's very OCD and organized and has all the traits and everything. But she also has a passion for kids and stuff. So she's actually going to go to Boise State in August and study. She's going to do education. So she wants to be a teacher.
Good for her.
Yeah.
We need those. Oh, yes. Need more of those for sure.
Yeah. Do you get to do anything fun that doesn't involve bikes?
Not very much. No. Well, the funny thing is like, especially like the first 100 days of this year, like I went to Dakar with Ricky. We came back.
Wide open, huh?
And then it was like Grand Prix, Heron Hound, Grand Prix, Heron Hound. And we were just like jamming up until like last weekend. But we got to this last weekend and I was like, okay, light at the end of the tunnel. I can, you know, get back in the shop, get all these projects caught up. And so we don't have a race for like another month.
Hey, can you come on the Whiskey Throttle Show now that you actually have some time?
Yeah. But for me,
we'll take away that free time.
Yeah, for me, that's great. But like, I think that then, you know, I might not have even ridden, but once or twice in that 100 days. But when I get home, it's like, hey, Faye, let's go do a dual sport ride or whatever.
That's cool.
So I still love bikes, but
yes,
but it's a lot.
It's different.
Yeah. So just reconnecting with her. And now our kids are almost out of the house. So, you know, we want to just start doing some rides and some different things. And
does she do pretty well when you're gone? I mean,
she does an awesome job.
Because it's tough, you know, like even as a fireman, I'm gone at least 10 to 12 days, like 24-hour periods a month. And you got to have a strong woman at home to you know, if you're somebody who travels. Yeah, it's not easy.
Yeah.
Being a mom, she works. It's like...
No, she does great. And since we moved out to Murrieta 4 years ago, you know, we got a piece of property. So we got like 5 acres. There's always... stuff to do, you know, trimming. We have an orchard of grapefruits that
that's cool.
I think I'm gonna mow them down.
A lot of work,
but fruit sounded like a good idea.
Yeah. It's beautiful and it smells good and the fruit's great, but it's like this year we have 70 trees, there's like 15,000 pieces of fruit, and nobody wants to come and buy them or pick them or whatever.
Yeah.
It's like we've been able to sell them the last couple years, but. This year is like, no, we're not interested, not interested. So now you end up with all this fruit. And
you can only eat so many damn grapefruit. And you're like.
We water them. We fertilize them. You know, we have a guy that takes care of the grounds that helps me a couple days or, you know, at least like 3 or 4 days a month. And with all that, you know, I don't know, we might make $1,000 on a good year.
Yeah.
He's like,
he needs to bring in his
spent 2,000.
Yeah, maybe some avocado trees.
Yeah,
everyone likes them some guacamole.
Guacamole. How much do you ever get to surf anymore or anything like that?
Not very often.
No,
but I'll definitely gonna hit it this summer a little bit, and at least before I go to Russia with the rally team. So
Russia.
Yeah,
what's going on over there?
So the World Rally, the FIM World Rally events, they have one in Abu Dhabi. They just had it, and then they have the new one is the Silkway Rally, Russia, Mongolia, China, and it's July 6th through the 16th. And so,
is that safe?
No.
It's like, why didn't they even hesitate. They have these rallies in the worst possible places.
They're like, hey, we just want to add in
next year. We're going to go Afghanistan, Iran, and...
So
the Gaza Strip.
Where
else? Yeah, we finished down the Gaza Strip.
Yeah.
You got to wear a Star of David flying
off
the back.
By the way, don't get off the beaten path.
Yeah.
There's landmines.
Yeah. So, that's probably going to happen. And then August, we'll have a bunch of rally durability testing. The end of July, I wanted to mention this, was Cameron Steele, myself, and Ken Neal from Bulletproof Diesel. We, for the 11th year in a row, this will be our 11th, we host the Baja Beach Bash.
I read about that.
So the Baja Beach Bash is a charity ride that we host every year, and we drive down to San Vicente. It's about 2 hours south of the border.
Okay.
And there's Rancho Santa Marta is a school, teaching school and orphanage. And so they have some kids that live there, and then some kids get bused in, and they teach the kids, you know, from elementary through high school, but they also teach them trades. Like, they'll teach them, like, how to do masonry and stuff that's useful. And so over the last decade, we've been able to raise funds for them and also see some of the changes and stuff that are being made in kids' lives, kids going to college and different things. And so last year was our biggest year of fundraising. We raised $156,000.
Nice. In that, just last year?
Just last year. So we've raised almost $500,000 total in the last decade for him.
That is awesome.
But
in Mexico, that goes a long way too.
It does. And it helps with like the teaching staff and all sorts of things. They built a gymnasium and whatever. But, so anyway, we go down and we do a 3-day ride, 3.5 days. We have a really good time. We go to the orphanage. We present them with all our, pledges and stuff. And, we bring our own catering and stuff that follows us on the trail and whatever, and we have lunches set up. But it's a really fun trail ride. It's mostly all single track. We've cut in a bunch of single track ride down the beaches, and it's hot, you know, everywhere else, so this is usually pretty mild.
Yeah. What was the date again?
So it's July 26th through the 29th.
Okay.
And it's the Baja Beach Bash. Go to BajaBeachBash.com, and you can see how to sign up and come down. And cool. We usually have around 50 riders.
Okay.
So it's pretty good, but we want to start the fundraising now. And
so those entry fees are what generates the revenue, or how does that work?
No, their entry fees basically pay for the ride costs. You know, there's hotels and food and stuff and gas. And stuff. That's basically the ride cost. And then the pledges are what everybody brings in. You know, there's certain companies that do matching funds. Like if we raise $25,000, they put in, you know, that. Awesome. And so, we every year, you know, God willing, we've been able to really raise the bar on the fundraising. But it's totally up to him. It's his economy. You know, I have a saying that my friend Travis at TBT is say, it's God's economy. You know, it's all his money.
Yeah.
You know, it's what we do as good stewards to put it in the right places, right?
Yeah. Yep.
So that's how it's been for the Beach Bash. It's just like, sometimes it's like, I don't know how it's happening. It's just like, it just comes in.
That's awesome.
But anyway, we want to, we love the cause and supporting them. And Rod and Tina, they're an American couple that run the facility and stuff.
And so Cameron goes down and does that with you?
Yeah. So Cameron's kind of the spearhead of it. Yeah. And stuff, and then I've helped him run it, support it, you know, manage the ride and stuff, and then we have a third partner who's Ken Neal from Bulletproof Diesel. He builds diesel trucks and stuff in Arizona.
Okay.
But anyway, it's an awesome ride. It's fun. We usually do a little video for it every year, and you know, but the main point for us, or for me, is to raise the money for the kids. You know,
of course.
And help provide a better outcome for them.
Yeah, they definitely need it down there. Yeah. It's a rough area, huh?
Yeah, so it could be really bad. So
Everyone deserves a chance.
Yeah. Well, listen, we really appreciate you coming on. It's been an honor, man. The El Campeón. Your career has been incredible.
Thanks.
It's sure fun to watch what you've done after. As we talked about, that's not always easy.
Yeah.
Figuring out what the heck you're going to do with the rest of your life at 30 or 35.
Yeah.
It's tough for racers, you know.
Yeah.
And we were talking about this with somebody the other day. It's like if you're a football or basketball, some other kind of athlete, and your career ends, you've only been doing that for, you know, throughout your college and whatever time, right? But as motocrossers, we start at 5.
Yeah.
Your whole identity is just tied to racing motorcycles.
Yeah.
Or 9 or whatever, however old you were when you started. But I think that makes it extra difficult. We don't get any college.
Yeah.
You know, we typically forego that to race.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I mean, you know.
Some kids needed to go to college.
It's just tough, you know.
Go to a regular public school, maybe.
It's a tough deal. So it's fun to watch somebody be successful after racing. And,
thank you.
And we'll keep watching for more JCR championships.
I'm pretty excited for the car.
Yeah.
Like, well, this year, I'm like, I really want to see you guys go get it done. So I'll be glued to that one.
Awesome.
We'll be making sure to help watch and help promote that. So
there's a lot of blood, sweat, and tears that go into that program, not just from me. There's a lot of people that help it.
It's a big operation, like we're saying. Like you said, you gear around almost a year for something like that.
Yeah, we'll have 5 riders on the team, and you know, there'll be 40 total people on the team moving that whole thing. Oh, and this year it's in Saudi Arabia.
Yeah.
They moved it.
I just, when did crazy. I just see that? I just saw that on a press release.
You going to wear a bulletproof vest again?
Nah.
Well, good luck, man. Again, thank you for coming on the show. Yeah. We sure appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you guys. Appreciate it.
It was fun. Awesome.
Yep.
Awesome stuff. Thanks, Johnny.
Yep.
Thanks. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back. That was the Baja King, Johnny Campbell. Stay tuned.
4WP is more than a store. We're truck and Jeep experts. From wheel and tire upgrades to full custom builds, 4WP has you covered. Do your rig right. Shop online or find your store at 4WP.com.
Everybody, welcome back to the Whiskey Throttle Show. We just wrapped up with Johnny Campbell, and what a good dude.
Very intelligent as well. I enjoy listening to all the different things he's tried out. I mean, like he said, he was at a car, you know, working on cars and bikes and engines and splitting and R&D and helping Honda. He's a pretty well-rounded guy, really.
You can tell he's very mechanically inclined and something that I think you don't really think about, but when you're managing a team or managing an operation like that, you have to be very detail-oriented.
Yeah.
And he seems almost, like he mentioned, a little bit OCD, like he might need to get on some meds, but that lets you like really make sure all everything is lined up and you're not leaving anything out, you know?
And as usual, we always learn new stuff, so that's
cool. This is something that I love about doing this show is that I've heard about Johnny Campbell. I've watched from a distance. You see, oh, man, he's all these Baja wins and he's this legendary off-road racer, but I didn't know much about him. Mm-hmm. You just don't really run in the same circles, even though he lives 15 miles from me, and we work in the motorcycle industry.
Yeah,
it's just funny.
And he's been around a long time, and he's seen a lot of transitions through the sport.
Yeah, absolutely. No, really, really cool interview. We want to get to the four-wheel parts Get At Me Q&A. If you guys have questions about anything, send them to us on Twitter, and Grant can share with that. With you guys, that pile of junk Twitter handle. Let's hear what it is.
Actually, it's been a while. What is it? At W underscore
Throttle underscore Show.
Oh, wait.
Or just search Whiskey Throttle Show. It'll pop up. But I just like to tease Grant about how terrible that thing is. It's really the worst I've ever seen.
Do you want to try and find a better one?
No. Okay. I want to continue to give you. Give you shit about it for the entirety of this show. But send us questions. We'll answer anything you got, truly. And we have a lot of fun. It's brought to you by 4wheelparts.com, the number 4wheelparts.com. Check those guys out for anything truck, off-road, UTV related. They carry it all, including Method race wheels. If you need tires, steps, lights, winches, I mean, you name it. Anything that you could possibly need for a vehicle, 4wheelparts has.
I was in the one at Temecula the other day, and I almost bought stuff I didn't need.
I know.
I'm like, oh, that's a plug-in freezer for the back. I got to have one of those. Summer's coming.
It's a little bit like going into Home Depot for your vehicle, right? Because I do that at Home Depot. I'm like, oh, look at this hose rack. It's got wheels. I don't need one, but I need that.
I need it,
I've got to have that.
It's like Costco. I'm going to buy in bulk and save money. Yeah. How the hell did I spend $1,000?
Babe, we don't have a Jeep. Why did you buy a winch? Well, I don't know. If 4Wheel Parts had it, it was on sale.
Exactly.
Anyway, check 4Wheel Parts out. Also, service. You need anything done to your vehicle, any of these parts put on, they do all of that. So, and they do a great job. So, thanks to 4Wheel Parts. Donnie, DJ Donnie.
Yo.
What do we got today for some questions?
Well, I got a question here. How do riders at this time of year handle going from supercross racing to motocross testing and back to supercross? Because they're not finished racing mm-hmm. Supercross when they're doing this.
Yeah, this was always, to me, this was always a reason I enjoyed riding for the lights guys, riding the 250 West, because you got that big break. And to me, it gives them a huge advantage going into the outdoors. You get a break from Supercross, you get all your outdoor testing done, and then you can go back to Supercross, finish out the season strong, and you've already got your bike ready to go. Where the East Coast guys, yeah. they kind of have to run it straight through. They don't get as much time. They're relying on settings that the other guys have come up with, and it's definitely a shorter window. For the 450 guys, yeah, it's tough.
Well, basically for the 450 guys, they've been through it doing the West Coast or the East Coast. So they've sort of had a little dabble at having to do that, go back and forth. But once you get to 450s, it's tough because teams might say, we're testing on these days. You may be tired. You may not have a little injury. You may not feel good. You got to get that testing in because when you got that much time, you don't test, you might be dealing with issues coming into the opening round. So, and in fact, remember that one year, Dungy at Hangtown finished 10th overall.
It was terrible.
Without crashing, without anything.
Yeah.
I remember that year I was behind him part of the race and he struggled and everyone was like, oh, what happened? And after talking to him, he said they were so focused on Supercross that the couple times they were meant to test, he missed a test session and only got one in at one specific track, thought they were good, went to Hangtown and realized, all right, back to the drawing board. Yeah. So, and then a week later, I think he came out and won. But they spent all week retesting.
And you'll see that happen a lot of times. Supercross, the guys who are in contention for those Supercross championships, they'll start the outdoor season slow because their focus is indoors. That's it. They're like, forget that outdoor stuff. We'll sort that out when the time comes.
Yeah.
And so that means they usually have about a week and a half of testing,
yeah.
A time to get ready riding and testing, and it's usually not enough. But also, I think it's good to see, like, when we had Adam Ciancirillo on here, he'd have days off. He'd go ride outdoors, ride a 450. Yeah. Sometimes I think it's good just to mix it up because in Supercross, your corner speed kind of falls off a little.
That happened to me when I first came here. After GPs, I had great corner speed, got so used to trying to work at Supercross, I realized I was getting the jumps and the whoops down, but the corner speed had gone. So yeah. I had to go, you know, and then I started trying to incorporate at least a day of outdoor riding every week. And if not every week, every other week.
Every couple weeks.
And then as I got closer to the time, you start doing that sliding scale where Supercross days are becoming less and your motocross days are becoming more.
Yeah, different guys handle it differently, but those are some of the ways they probably are getting through that. And another thing teams are doing these days is hiring guys to test for them.
Yeah.
So we've got Ivan Tedesco is I don't know if he's on payroll at Pro Circuit, but he definitely goes out with those guys a lot and gets a rough setting for them so that when the team guys jump on, it's already a lot of the bugs are worked out and they kind of know, hey, you're going to probably end up somewhere in here.
Well, it's not even just that. A lot of times that initial testing is like, we got to just see if this part fails or not, you know. And unfortunately, as the test rider, you're the guinea pig.
Ivan, this may blow up. All right, go ride for 2 hours straight now.
Yeah.
Have fun.
Yeah, so it's a little bit like that. But also, when those guys come back, they can bring back data and information. Even if it's not really to set a bike up for a specific rider, they have a lot more data and information about what the bike's doing. And then when you talk to a rider, especially younger ones that maybe are a little inexperienced when it comes to testing, they can say, I kind of just want this feeling, and then they can go back to the notes and go, well, based on our test rider who's established, knows what he's talking about, this is what we think could help that. So anyway, it just helps speed up the process as well and eliminate like actual shit that doesn't work.
Yeah, and I think a lot of the engine setups, they're not different from one to the other really at all. So
not
it's
much.
Like they'll have Ivan go out and sort out a good engine package.
Yeah.
And then really it's chassis and suspension that are more personalized for the
riders.
Well,
like you said, if there's a good engine package, it's easier for a guy to go, I would like a little more bottom end, or I'd like a little more torque, or a little more high end, you know, so then you can work from that base package.
Yeah. Yeah. So Trey Kennard's been out doing some testing for Honda. Like I said, Ivan's been testing for Pro Circuit. So I think Will Hahn even does a bit of the testing for Yamaha still. So.
And they use other people as well.
Yeah. So that's how they do it.
Mm-hmm. Michael Mosman has really been on the gas the last couple of weeks. Where do you think that speed came from?
Yeah, he's been coming on. Like, he was impressive there at Denver. I think that he's had little flashes of speed, and you could see that he's talented, but I think a start is a big part of it. And he got up front and just pinned it. And I think now, I believe, now that he's seen the front and he's seen that pace, it'll be easier for him next time.
Well, there's always, to me, there's always a process of becoming a top rider, or you know, a winner or a champion. And so often people forget having speed or talent is literally just the beginning at this level. You've got to put all these pieces together. So, and it, you can't go from being fast to winning. There's stages where you get the taste for that lead pace. You got to get used to being up front, the intensity, then cutting out mistakes, not panicking, being relaxed, you
now
know, breathing. Yeah. So, you know, it's building blocks. So like you said, now that he's had a taste, I think you might see him starting to really pick it up.
He took a big step for his career in Denver. That was good to see.
And he looked good, too. He was completely in control and actually, you know, kept Cianciarulo at bay.
Yeah, it's impressive to see him fight with guys, because a lot of times, guy that's not used to being up front, he'll look back and say, oh, it's Cianciarulo, he's leading the points, I'll let him go by and follow. And then they're like, oh, I'll let him go out and follow him. And pretty soon you're following 10th place.
He fought back after a couple of times when he got passed. He didn't just roll over. He fought back, and I was like, that's cool. I like it when you see a guy with a little character.
He says it says he knows he belongs there.
Yeah, that's what we think.
That's all I got, man.
That's it.
Yeah.
Well, everyone else was on spring break, too. Then.
Yeah, everybody. nice job sending in questions. We had two. So that's your 40 parts. Get at me Q&A. Again, send us questions. We'll answer them. Anything. So we're going to move on to our Decal Works last call segment. Decal Works, the official sponsor of the Red Bull KTM team. Lots of privateer teams. They are going to be building our graphics here behind the set, which hopefully we'll have done next week. Pit boards, garage mats, any kind of graphics for chest protectors, helmets, anything you need, they've got it. Check out decalworks.com. Those guys do an awesome job, and we're proud to have them a part of the show. And they're also giving away, they give away 5 tickets to every live show here. Our next one is going to be May 10th. It's a little ways off, but follow us on Instagram to be eligible to win those. That's where we'll pull our winners from, at Whiskey Throttle Show. So check those guys out. In this installment of the Decal Works Last Call, we got a hold of Ricky Brabeck. We figured he's riding underneath the helm of Mr. Johnny Campbell that we had on today, so he'd be a good guy to chat with. This is a guy that I'm going to be pulling for hard to win that rally, that Dakar rally next year. Just after you hear the whole story and everything that's behind it and all of that, and he was so close this year.
Yeah. It was heartbreaking. I felt for the guy, and I hadn't even met him, and I was like, gosh, that's a tough one. When you know everything that goes into it and being that close, I felt for him for sure.
Well, we got Ricky on the phone. Let's have a listen.
Hey, Ricky, how you doing?
Good, good.
Good stuff, man. Hey, thanks for coming on the show.
Yeah, thank you. Stoked to be on the show, and thank you for having me.
Awesome stuff. You know, we're very honored to have you guys. Some off-roading royalty. We just had your team boss, Johnny Campbell, on, and obviously you guys work together. How is that relationship like?
Oh, the relationship with Johnny Campbell and myself is really strong. We get along really great. You know, we're really close friends. He's obviously my boss and my manager. But, to work with someone like him, he's an off-road legend, he's really smart, really knowledgeable, and, I'm really thankful to have him, you know, in my corner and help me out with rally and off-road racing here in America.
No, it seems like it's a great partnership. Speaking of rally, I know a lot of us really felt for you last year in the Dakar, some heartbreak. Tell us more. You know, from the outside, we see the heartbreak, but there's a lot that goes into an event like that.
Yeah, you know, Dakar, it's like a one of a kind. It only happens once a year. And as many people know, you know, no American's ever won. And to be leading in the overall standings for more than, you know, 4 days, that's like a dream come true. And, 2 days left to have to bail out of the rally due to mechanical was really heartbreaking. It's like the Baja 500 every day, you know, and we had it for 10 days. So, you know, I really wanted to be the first one to do it, the first American to put it on top. And, it was a big heartbreak, but, you know, looking forward, there's always more years to come, and that's kind of what my main focus is right now.
No, absolutely, great attitude, and that old saying, you have a little bad luck sometimes, but eventually that good luck will come around. So moving forward, 2019, what does your year look like?
For 2019, my year is pretty simple. You know, racing for Johnny Campbell here in the States. I'm doing a few selective, you know, big races, the Mint 400, Vegas Torino, and the National Hare and Hound Series. Unfortunately, about 4 weeks ago, I had a little crash, you know, in Sonora Rally in Mexico, which I didn't think anything of it. You know, you crash on your dirt bike, you pick it up, you keep going, you're sore for a couple days. And unfortunately, you know, after that rally, I flew to Idaho to try to race the Hare and Hound, you know, the next day, and was unable to finish that one. Long story short, you know, 3 weeks later, I go to the doctor's. I have a broken collarbone, and, you know, I just had surgery 2 days ago. So now I'm kind of just on the road to recovery. I think it'll be 2 to 3 weeks. You know, I got a plate and screws in the old collarbone, so that's nice and sturdy.
Well, that's, unfortunately, the life of a racer, man, such a strong start to the year, and then something like that. But we do know that you have some time to get back, get fit, get healthy. Have to ask you, I'm sure it's your main focus, but Dakar 2020, Saudi Arabia, what do you think about that?
Yeah, Saudi Arabia next year, 2020 Dakar. You know, I'm excited. You know, I have a really fun job. I get to ride a motorcycle, you know, all around the world. And Saudi Arabia, I think, is going to even out the playing field. You know, they've been in South America for 11 years or something like that. And obviously, the more you go somewhere, the more resources you have with friends and friends of friends, you know, to know the route and know kind of where we're going. Where yeah. In Saudi Arabia, we haven't been there in like 30 years, so we're all going to go there and it's all going to be equal rights. You know, no one's going to know more information than someone else. So for me, being an American, I think it's going to be a lot more fair. But like I said, I'm ready to get there and win the thing and lay the hammer down.
I like that attitude. And that's a good point, evening out the playing field. Well, if the odds were against you last year, I think people might be a little nervous this year. But, Ricky, on behalf of a lot of your fans out there, we wish you all the best, speedy recovery, and kick some ass in Dakar. And finally, we're gonna get you on this show sooner or later. So we look forward to that as well.
Yeah, thank you, Grant. You know, I'm more than willing to come on the show. It sounds like a good time. My good buddy, Phil Holcomb, told me all about it. Johnny told me about it. So let me know. I'll come down.
We look forward to it. Take care of yourself, and we'll chat soon, man.
All right. Thank you, Grant. See you guys.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
All right. Well, good stuff. Good stuff. Good phone interview. Good way to wrap up the show. We sure appreciate Johnny Campbell coming on and learned a lot about that guy. Mm. What a legend, man. The king of Baja. Kind of like Jeremy's the king of Supercross.
Yeah.
I don't think there's any denying that dude's the king of Baja.
Yeah,
so,
for sure.
Great to have him on. I want to thank all of our sponsors. PowerDot.com. Go there. Check that out. Whiskey Throttle gets you 20% off at checkout. Method Race Wheels. Big supporter of this show. If you did not win the Dirtfish Rally School, which you know who you are, you did not win. We did not call you.
You know you're
sign
a loser.
Yeah. We're going to do another one in the fall.
Know, then you know.
And the guy who won signed up really early, like back in early January. And he's like, oh man, what did I sign up for? He didn't even realize what he was signing up for. But he won. So get in there and sign up. That's what I'm telling you. Go to Whiskey or go to methodracewheels.com and sign up for that. Big thank you to Troy Lee Designs providing us the saloon here and really backing this show. From design to the products they make, man, couldn't be more happy with being involved with Troy Lee Designs. I've been with them for years and years. Mm. Decal Works, Dunlop Tires, the industry standard. Look, there's no one else supporting the sport like Dunlop is, so support them. They send people to every single race, making sure that all the factory teams have what they need. They send people to all the amateur races, taking care of amateur kids trying to make it.
And their tires are the best.
It's the best tires out there.
I just put some freshies on my bike.
And they've got a new tire coming out. Can't give that away yet, but coming out very soon. It's going to be something geared towards a little bit more hard pack, but not what their old hard pack tire was. It could be game changing for those terrains, so check that out. 4wheelparts.com, Adidas. Thanks for the shoes, man. If you aren't wearing Adidas shoes when you're training or running or just cruising around, you're blowing it. Your feet are pissed.
they're pissed at you.
Make your feet happy. Don't be a dick. Pro Circuit. Yep. Those guys, they race. They win. They win a lot.
Jeez, they just keep winning.
Yeah, they're queued up to
they're
to
on
win
fire
this
year.
This West Coast Championship. Tomac just won with their exhaust system. ProCircuit.com. Check those guys out. And Hilo Concepts. If you're looking for foot pegs, you're looking for anything for a Husky or KTM, little parts to really dial in your bike, check those guys out. They're getting into more and more products as well.
I was going to say, the best thing to do is just go check out their website, because you realize, oh, wow, they make a lot of cool knick-knack stuff as well that you wouldn't maybe normally think of.
Yeah, it's true, and it's really good stuff too. Big thank you to Paleo Ranch, Langston Motorsports. Thank you guys for watching. We will be back next week with another show. That's the Whiskey Throttle Show. See ya.